Good afternoon, everybody. Ben Cola here. And just wanted to go through our show today. And I wanted to provide some answers to why I would make a better leader for this country than the current gaggle of existing cronies that just want to go around in circles and become the leader of this country. It's funny because yesterday I had to go and buy my medicine that I need to keep to stay alive, because President Obama told us there wasn't any danger from Fukushima, yet strangely enough I was outside when the plume hit, and now we're being told that I should have been taking potassium iodine pills. I was actually out in the rain in the worst part of the country as it was raining on me, because I was sailing in a place where we now find out that was the worst place to be. And as a result, I almost died of a heart attack. But thank God that we were able to dial for an ambulance, 911, as I collapsed right here, and my blood pressure hit 300 over 200, and it sure felt like a heart attack to me, but the hospital immediately ruled that out and told me that my thyroid was shot because I had been irradiated by iodine, so a radioactive iodine. It could only have come from a fresh nuclear reaction. So, you know, I'm frankly sick and tired of being lied to by our government. And as we know now, we're finding out that the government is legally, they're absolutely allowed to propagandize and legally lie to us. I mean, can you imagine the United States of America, home of the free and the brave, actually has to resort to lying and propagandizing the people? I remember when I was a kid growing up, I told you the stories about going to city of Wildwood at the South Jersey seashore in the summertime with my genius father, and going swimming. I remember in the middle of the beach there was a huge flagpole that you could see for maybe a three-quarters of a mile, maybe even a mile. It was a big pole and a big flag. And if you got to the beach at about 10 o'clock in the morning, they would be playing the Star Spangled Banner, and everyone would say the Pledge of Allegiance, and everyone on the beach would stand up and they would do the Pledge of Allegiance, and you would sing the National Anthem as the flag was being raised. And then later in the day, they would lower the flag. But, you know, back in those days, I mean, I'm going back to 1960, I mean, it would be unthinkable today for you to even imagine that the United States of America can lie, flat-out lie on national television to its people about the state of the economy, about war, about trade pact agreements. But now we have these secret agreements like the Trans-Pacific, the TPP going through, which is secret. Our own congressmen are not allowed to see the whole thing at once. They have to look at one section at a time. They have to go in a special room. They're not allowed to take any photocopying equipment with them, their camera, their cell phone. All they can do is sit there and read one page at a time, I guess, and they're not allowed to take notes. So, and not only that, but they're trying to push this thing through to give the president some kind of superpower so that he can act quickly on his own. Now, I know from being an insurance agent, an insurance adjuster, and a real estate broker all my life that anytime someone tells you, quick, 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 sign the paper, that you're being screwed every single time. Now, to give the president some kind of power, power that you're giving him, that you don't even know what that power is that you're giving him, to authorize him to make trade agreements for the rest of the country, supposedly on behalf of the country, to benefit the country, well, I smell a rat. I smell a rat because I'm an experienced real estate broker, and I know that when we were negotiating real estate deals, when the other side says, you better hurry up and sign the paper, usually it was always the opposite. It usually meant that their position was weak, and they want you to sign the paper before you have time and a chance to think about it. That's why in a lot of these clauses, especially when it comes to serious hurricanes and stuff, the government has enacted legislation that says that people have a 3-day right of rescission, because when they're under duress, for example, a tremendous hurricane hits, the insurance companies make them a quick offer to settle. They have a right to back out after a couple of days thinking about it. because they're under duress. Now, if we don't know what is in this Pacific Trade Agreement, and I have to think that this might be just another NAFTA coming down the road, and I'm glad to see that the Senate and our congressmen were able to hold it up. But I still say we need to throw these guys out, all of them. I don't have to get, even that we got to the point where we are today, I have to put the blame squarely on the senators and the congressmen that have gotten us to the point that we are today. For example, let me just give you an example of the fascism and the Gestapoism that we have today. And this is what the president of Russia and also the leader of China, Mr. Jinping, said, that they will not support a unipolar world and they will not support the rehabilitation of Nazis. I believe that that's what they're calling it. What we're doing in the Ukraine, they're calling that Nazism and militarism. And they're saying they are absolutely against it. And together they are going to block the formation of a unipolar world, which is what they're calling our so-called new world, I guess, one world order, where the United States dictates policy to the world. China and Russia are now standing together. And I'm sorry, folks, but I'm an American. I say the Pledge of Allegiance every day. I want us to be a strong country. I have no problem with us. I want to be the leader of the world. But you know what? That's not really the right way to go, folks. If you think deep down in your mind, heart, and soul, you realize that that's not the way people are. People around the world, and I told you this before, if you go through my shows, my videos, you'll see that I said repeatedly that a new world order where you have a single set of guidelines, like Agenda 21 or something similar to that, where everybody falls under a certain set of guidelines that goes beyond the United Nations Charter on Human Rights, which everybody has basic human rights. I have no problem with that. But when you start talking about how they're supposed to live, like the Agenda 21 and addressing carbon standards and stuff like that, you know, I submit to you also, by the way, the carbon standards. That's ridiculous, too, because our chief problem today, which they don't want to talk about, is nuclear. We are being radionucleated to death. Our background radiation levels are going up, and no one's talking about it. I guess they're just too stupid to know anything about nuclear radiation and these daughters of these radionuclides that are spreading all around the Earth from the likes of Fukushima and from years ago, even the garbage and crap left over from the open-air bomb tests during the Cold War era are still laying on our front lawns. And if you have sensitive equipment, you can measure it today. But I tell you right now, our number one killer is going to be that Fukushima. And we need to plug that thing up right now. You need to go back and look at my earlier shows about Fukushima. But let's get back to the subject matter at hand. We are viewed around the world as flat-out liars. Now, I told you that the United States is legally allowed to spread propaganda to its own people. Well, they've been spreading propaganda around the world for years and years, and the people around the world are just about over it. We need to have a leader of this country who is going to deal in honesty with the people around the world. We do not have the power to police the entire earth, nor is it really right or just to patrol the whole world. People around the world have their own way of doing things, and they want to live in their own way, and they don't want to be dictated to or ruled over, and they don't want to have this foreign country. To them, the United States is a foreign country coming in and telling them what to do, telling them how to live their lives, giving them a so-called outline. And then every once in a while, we raid their country. Well, we may raid their country if they're, say, in South America. Okay, well, maybe we'll just send a Delta Force or a small squad of Navy SEALs just to shoot up a building or two and capture one or two so-called bad people that the people down there, if they viewed them as bad, they could have arrested them themselves. And we agitate the whole country and certainly, and we dictate the drug policy to them. But anyway, getting back to this Pacific Trade Pact thing, to have a bill sneaking its way through the Congress, signed off by the Senate or whatever, and now President Obama wants to sign it. Well, thank God the Senate was able to block this thing, because we don't know what it says. It might say that they want to chop off everybody's heads. I mean, it could, at this point, with all the crap that's been that we've been doing, it could say anything. Now, let's just, for example, say that maybe all it is more fascism. That's the least bad thing that it could be, is just another dose of fascism, ladies and gentlemen, and more loss of jobs to these foreign countries that have a lower cost of labor. Let me just tell you what I think it says, or the gist of it. I think the gist of it revolves around, we already know that it's been announced that there is some information in there about medication and the control of medication. So now I guess we're going to have a medicine czar. Certain corporations are going to have the right to import medications. Now, we just talked about Fukushima. Now, my thyroid went. I have to take medicine every day. So I would imagine whoever is going to be in charge of the thyroid medication is going to become a new god oligarch-like person on Earth, because he's in charge of whether you live or die and the cost of those thyroid pills. Okay, now do we really want this, or would it be better if each independent pharmacy at their wholesale level could pick up the internet or the telephone, through the internet they could contact the wholesalers of these medications overseas, and they could strike their own deal. So we would have true capitalism. That's what we want. We want capitalism. We do not want fascism. We do not want oligarchs to be formed. We do not want the fascism to allow certain corporations to have the upper hand in acquiring goods overseas, and anyone else who tries to obtain the goods has to buy them from this godlike person who is sort of like Apophis in the Stargate SG-1 episode. Just watch Stargate 1, and where there's the god who has a spaceship, a whole fleet of spaceships flying around the universe, and what he does is he pulls in over your world, and you've got this one particular fella whose name is Apophis. He sort of looks like President Obama a little bit, and he's dictating policy. And if you don't listen to him and bow down before him, well, all kinds of bad things could happen to you. Well, basically, I'll tell you the short story, you're enslaved. And if you're not enslaved, you're basically killed off from space. They just blow you up from outer space. You have no chance to fight back, and they have armies that come down and land. That's what I think this Pacific trade thing. I don't think we should have any trade agreements signed off by the government. The government has no business whatsoever signing these trade agreements. These trade agreements should be allowable with any corporation. For example, if I have stock in XYZ Corporation, and maybe they're not the biggest corporation in their line or field of business, I would like to know that as a shareholder of some smaller corporation, that my smaller corporation could hire someone like me and send me overseas to where they make the so-called thyroid medication and strike our own deal. And maybe we're not buying enough thyroid medication to cover the whole United States, because maybe our corporation isn't that big, but we're buying enough that we can look around and negotiate our own deal instead of me having to call up the god, the United States oligarch who is in charge and the only person who is allowed to touch the medication for thyroids, or for whatever, your heart medication, whatever else they may dream up. And then all of a sudden that person is an oligarch and making a fortune. And you could just imagine that this whole system is rife for abuse. And that's why really they don't want anybody to see this thing, because it would name the corporations that are going to get the upper hand. And then that would allow you to purchase stock in those corporations in advance. I guess that would be insider trading. So maybe there's, you know, maybe you could say the only good to it would be, well, they're trying to prevent too many people from insider trading. But the fact is, if there is a law being created by the government that is going to boost the price of a particular stock in a particular corporation, then that's giving the upper hand to one corporation over another. And that is fascism. It's the merger of the government and corporate powers. So the government is then helping and one corporation at the cost of another. Now, I'm not one of these guys who says, look, the CEOs of these corporations make too much money. No. You know, if the CEO of a corporation is making too much money, the shareholders are just going to vote him a decrease in pay. And unless they're happy with their CEO and the pay package that they provide him, trust me, they could vote that guy out. They could throw him out. They could terminate him. They could say you're earning too much, or you're not producing, you're not pulling your weight, or you're not doing enough to make you worthy of such a pay package. And remember, you pay taxes, by the way, on whatever pay package you get. So far as I'm concerned, I mean, the more you earn, the more the IRS is going to take. So I don't see why the government would be so upset about these individuals who may be in positions of high pay in the corporations that happen to. I'm a firm belief that unless you're helped by the government through a fascist dictatorial system of somehow, that everything else comes either from talent or it comes from a luck of some kind. Because even President Obama yesterday, when he was talking about disparity in income levels, disparity of treatment, which, by the way, I pioneered the talk of disparate treatment in my Allstate, Cola versus Allstate lawsuit, which you could go back and look at those old shows and see. I'm still, to this day, fighting for those poor African Americans in Sanford, Florida, over what this Allstate Corporation and the Computer Associates Company did to these people with their algorithms that decided that they were crappy automobile drivers because they had a ding on their credit report, or they didn't have any debt whatsoever. They weren't allowed to buy car insurance. Now, can you imagine that you don't have any credit card yet, so automatically they say you're a lousy automobile driver, and they either won't give you insurance or they're going to give you a high rate. It's so high, you just assume go somewhere else. Well, I owned an Allstate office that was doing this to the people, and I sued over it, and I'm still not done with these people. So, as far as I'm concerned, that case is still going, and I put my whole career on hold. For years, I did nothing but fight full-time against these corporations that are doing this, namely Allstate, and backed up by the Computer Associates, who had an algorithm, which, by the way, we would never were able to get a hold of the algorithm, because guess what? It was a secret. A secret. Can you imagine? Now, my father is a mathematician, a genius. I already told you, he wanted to get his hands on that thing, too, because when I explained it to him, he said, oh, well, you know, it could be true, but it could be a lot of baloney as well. He said, get me a copy of the algorithm. Well, I never was able to get a copy of the algorithm that proved that if you didn't have any credit card, that you were a lousier driver than someone who did have a credit card. I mean, that whole thing was baloney. And then it was followed up by the state of Florida, who also could not get a hold of these insider secrets. Because, you see, these corporations, when they invent a way of a method of making, say, Pepsi Cola, or they invent the formula for a drug, or they invent the formula for how they're going to figure out what they're going to charge you for car insurance, that is considered to be off base and out of bounds, and it is not even subpoenaable by even the Attorney General, cannot subpoena the thing. And the state of Florida, when they tried to get the information that I asked them to review and look at, they were denied. And it went all the way up to the Supreme Court of the state of Florida. And I took it almost to the Supreme Court of the United States. Of course, I stopped when they murdered my friend the day the order came at the appellate level, which I argued before the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals in Georgia. But the bottom line is, no one was ever able to get a hold of these so-called algorithmic secrets that proved that people who were poorer were more of a risk than people who were wealthier. Well, now, come on. You know, if they don't want to turn over the records, then that's proof that maybe there's something wrong with the records. So what did they do? Well, they offered a $25 million fine to the state of Florida, who, by the way, revoked their license over my complaint. I never saw a penny of it. I got totally destroyed in this whole thing and lost my complete investment in the downtown of Sanford, even though I had rehabilitated a part of the inner city for these poorer people in an effort to help them. And I just got wiped out. But even the state of Florida, with all its power as a state, was not able to get a hold of their information. But the Supreme Court of Florida did say, well, if they don't want to give you the information, you are allowed to revoke their license if you want the information. And that's part of the process by which they generate their rates. Because you see, in the insurance business, unlike the other people who are running for president, they don't know anything about the insurance business. They don't know anything about the real estate business. They don't know anything about the securities business. They never ran an agency all their lives. These people are wealthy oligarchs. Okay, and they talk about, some of them are talking now about how they cleaned toilets when they were younger. Well, I did too. Okay, I also owned my own toilet in my own little business. But the thing is, I actually ran my own little business. All right, I had to make a payroll every week for my secretarial staff back in the Ben Cola agency way back in the beginning. I was mentored by Clarence Stevens. As I told you, you can go back and you can watch show one. And by the way, I apologize for the quality of the show where I'm kind of leaning back. That was my first monologue. And the reason I did that show number one was just to try to explain to you who I am, because I do want to leave this country. And as they did a couple of days ago in the Carolinas, I wasn't able to take my turn at the mic because I frankly wasn't able to drive up there. I had to stay home and do a few things. I'm just not wealthy enough to jump in an airplane. I used to own my own airplane, but not wealthy enough to jump in a plane or buy a jet plane ticket or even to drive up there just to stand in front of a camera for about an hour to explain why I'm the better candidate. So this is my explanation and my answer as to why I would be the better candidate. I do have a plan how to fix this country, and I do know how to do it, and I am the best man for the job. I will restore our Constitution. But getting back to the subject matter at hand, the government of the United States should not be involved in creating these trade pacts. Okay, we should be in the business of having embassies around the world for the purposes of national security, and also to introduce our businesses to overseas. And to make introductions to people, and to try to overcome customs, and maybe to provide with translators, and to provide a venue for businesses and governments to come together so that we can derive a benefit from foreign trade. But that is not to mean to the detriment of the corporation whose name is not appearing on the TPP, because if your name does not appear on that Trans-Pacific agreement, which, by the way, is secret, and I can assure you that your name is probably not on there, and so you are not going to benefit. And now, all of a sudden, they're going to have somebody's name on there, and they're going to be in charge of all the bananas that come from South America, let's say, or they're going to be in charge of all the thyroid medication that comes, and it's all going to go flowing through one man who's going to have the sole exclusive right and power. And then the prices are going to go out of control, and then you're just going to generate another oligarch. I mean, this is bullshit, folks, and I am here to stop it. I'm here to tell you that an individual corporation, when they open in the United States of America, regardless of what state they're in, they have to put down what the reason is that they're incorporating. And I know that they put down any and all lawful reasons. Now, then they in turn focus on what they think that they can do best, or how they feel they can make the most amount of money. Remember, a corporation is a business. It's supposed to try to earn as much money as possible. It's no different than if you opened up a small business that was not a corporation. You were just a small business called a Schedule C business, where you just have your, it's a sole proprietorship. You do a Schedule C on your Internal Revenue Service every year. It's called the Schedule C sole proprietorship, versus having an ordinary corporation. But to have these gigantic corporations that are wealthy enough to hire lobbyists to get their names on that Trans-Pacific agreement, where all goods and services are going to somehow flow through this one oligarch, I mean, you can just imagine this thing is ripe for abuse, and it's fascism, because now you're putting one or two people in charge. I mean, it's no different than the Chicago mob, where the Chicago mob is going to say, well, you know, you're in charge of this side of town, and you, Mr. Big Boss, are in charge of the west side of town, and you, Mr. Big Boss, are in charge of the east side of town, and you're in charge of the north, and you're in charge of the south. And any kind of skim off comes back into the main conglomerate of, let's say, for example, back in Prohibition. I mean, that's the way they did it. And then you had the crime bosses, and they would take a skim off. And that's what this TPP thing is. It's just a legal way of saying who's going to get the skim off, and to the detriment of the other companies that may be trying as hard as they can, or new companies that want to open with new faces and new personalities that are fresh out of college. These people want to open up their own business because they can't get a job. So maybe they're going to want to open up their own business. Nothing wrong with that. Now all of a sudden they're going to be confronted with this TPP thing, and they're going to say, well, no matter what I do, I have to deal with the mobster who's in charge of all the thyroid medication. I can't open up my own company. Now I want to tell you another little story because you're probably going to hear about this. Back in 1999, maybe 2000, there was a bill going through the Congress. And they wanted to legalize the importation of prescription drugs. And I read the paper every day. I watch the news. I really stay up on the news every day. Ever since I was 7 years old with a newspaper out, I read the paper either before I delivered it or halfway. I read half the paper before I delivered it, and then maybe the other half when I was done. So literally every day of my life, I read the newspaper ever since I was 7 years old. I know what's going on around the town, at least around the world, at least what they tell me. Now, of course, today you watch the news, and if you're watching the mainstream news, you can pretty much assure that you're probably getting about half the picture, and the other half is twisting the first half that you saw. So, because they are, in fact, allowed to propagandize and lie. So don't believe everything you see on the TV. And as far as real life goes, you know, you probably should believe about half of what you see and about 10% of what you hear, or only about half of what you see, because they can make it look pretty good. And but it is lies. The truth is, let's look at the what's happening in this country, besides the Trans-Pacific thing, which, by the way, we should not be involved in that. That thing has got to go down. Any kind of a bill that's going through to be signed off into law that is so secret that our congressman can't read the whole thing in its entirety on their desk in their office and show it to their constituents, be able to answer questions about what it says. I mean, folks, these people are going to have to go. And I know it may not be your individual congressman, but you know what? When anything goes wrong and there's a problem, the person to blame is the captain. And right now, the captain of this ship is President Obama. Now, your congressman might not have a whole lot to that he can do or say about this thing, because the government at the top, the highest levels, is keeping it secret. And your congressman, if you ask him, may say, well, I bet your bippy that it's going to be someone related to whoever the lobbyists are that put this thing together, assuming it wasn't your congressman or your senator. But for argument's sake, let's just say that our senators and our congressmen are supposed to be the ones that put these bills together. Did they put this together? Well, if they did, why did they keep it a secret? Strike number one. Why you need to vote them out. Strike number two, if they didn't put it together, why did they let some lobbyists put it together instead of them putting it together themselves? And number three, why didn't they talk the president into through persuasion, which, by the way, I'm the best salesman. I've got the howitzer here, folks. I've got 11 sales evergreen awards. They're almost impossible to win through persuasion from Ben Cola, the Senate Ben. I could fix that really quick. I would make sure that there would be transparency, because what you're doing here is with that TPP, you're locking the United States of America and all its inhabitants into some kind of a contract that they can't even see. I mean, this is so preposterous. I can't, there's so many names for it that I don't even want to talk. I couldn't list them in the show. It would take me more than an hour to list how many crimes are being committed here. Racketeering for one. I think the FBI needs to investigate bring it up as a federal racketeering charge, because you have got people working in the background that are subverting capitalism in the United States of America, and they're thus subverting your right to free trade and antitrust violations. I mean, the list goes on and on and on and on. And your congressman is in this position where, you know, maybe there's one good thing in there, and he may need that so badly that he feels that he has to sign the rest, and then he's going to just throw his arms up and say, well, I had to sign it in order to get the one thing I wanted. And there might be 3,000 items in there. But the simple fact that he's got to go into a separate room, he can't bring his cell phone with him, he can't bring his assistant with him, he can't bring a tape recorder with him, he can't bring a video camera with him, he can't bring a photocopier with him, he doesn't have a copy of this thing, and they expect him to sign off on this thing as your representative, and you're letting this happen? No way. No way. Under my administration, I wouldn't allow this. Matter of fact, I would arrest these people for a RICO violation, racketeering. That's what this is. It's racketeering. It's racketeering and fascism, and it's monopolistic, and it's a violation of antitrust rules. And our FBI needs to investigate this. I mean, having a government that's working in secret is completely ridiculous in the United States of America. Our founding fathers would be rolling over in their graves. And to think that the government of the United States is involved in who gets to trade with who, under what terms and conditions, along with the overseas countries, with other countries. I mean, this is just a recipe for fascism, Nazism, Gestapoism. I mean, how do you know it doesn't say in there that our Homeland Security is now going to go over and provide physical protection and security for Venezuela? Now we're hoisting our Homeland Security rules and regulations on them, thus bypassing their usual and customary way of doing things. Maybe they like to smoke pot, and our Homeland Security is going to say, well, we're going to go and we're going to shoot right in the between the eyes with an M16 the pot dealers in Venezuela. Or we're going to give them the electric chair, or we're going to collar them, or we're going to do something bad to them. Look, folks, there's a reason that they have a Department of Customs, which I will not do away with as a leader. That's one thing I'm going to keep is the Department of Customs, because I realize that people in other countries have other ways of doing things. They have other ways of running their country. They have other ways of creating their own laws. They have certain rights, legal rights that they're allowed to partake in. Namely, many of these countries are more liberal with respect to drugs. And a lot of them, now they'll execute you if you have medication or drug or something that they catch you with, because 25, 30 years ago, they wouldn't have done that. But because the United States has been successful in brainwashing these people and bribing them at the highest level, which to me, I would put these people in jail who are bribing these foreign officials. But they're talking these foreign officials into saying, we're going to extend the war on drugs into your country. Now, something that they would have done if left alone, for example, maybe their de minimis drug like marijuana would be legal, and the cultivation of same would be legal. Now, under the auspices of the United States and some kind of agreement that we sign, if they don't want to arrest these people, we're going to come down there and just machine gun them all. I mean, you see where this is going? I mean, if you take this to the ultimate end, you're going to have nothing but oligarchs running the United States. Funny, because President Obama was talking about the people who are running the hedge fund managers and how much money they make. Well, hello. I mean, he's the one who allowed this to happen with the banker bailout. There was no language in that banker bailout when the crash hit and the initial $700 billion was doled out to the banks as to what they're supposed to do with it. And the bank said, well, this is Sunday night. I'll never forget. But on Sunday night, the head of the Treasury was contacted by the banks, and he called the president and said, well, if we don't bail the banks out right now, the world is going to come to an end. And tomorrow, Monday morning, there's going to be riots on the streets. The ATM machines might not work. There'll be loss of confidence. There'll be riots and civil commotion. Look, folks. Like I said, when the government is allowed to lie to you, you know, the people in the United States hear this, okay, just like if you look at my earlier show about what that judge said to me in the privacy of a courtroom that was empty, with the exception of me, my new attorney, and the judge. And go back and look at the show about lies and illegal judgeships. That's true. Here we have a case where a judge gave me a heads up. See, I knew that the government was allowed to lie to you before you did because of that judge. I didn't believe it until recently when I heard it officially, but that judge actually gave me a heads up because he said to me, there is no law against lying. Right in open court. I mean, I'm pretty sure we have a transcript on this thing. No law against lying. That's why this building is here, and that's why I'm here. I was so hysterical when he said that I ran down to the prosecutor's office and I demanded an investigation. And the you know what the prosecutor said? He said, oh, lying, well, I mean, unless the judge refers the case to me for a criminal, as a criminal case. Well, of course he wasn't going to refer it as a criminal case. It was just a civil dispute over a commission. How much the commission was supposed to be in a deal. Which, by the way, there was a contract covering it, so there shouldn't have been any question. But I guess the judge didn't like it because I made it look too easy. So they wanted to cut my commission down. So the judge just said, well, the lady's allowed to lie. And she said she didn't say she hired an attorney. Short story, she hired an attorney. They said they didn't sign a thing. And the judge said, well, I know. Yeah, really interesting. I hired a handwriting expert. And the handwriting expert died a couple of days before the court hearing. He died in his office drinking a cup of coffee right before he was going to testify that the woman had signed the document. But all things aside, it wouldn't have mattered. The judge just wanted to lower the commission because I didn't work that many hours on the case. So he said, big deal. Okay, so I made half the commission instead of the whole thing. Whatever. I still got paid. Point is, folks, you know, this TPP and any kind of secret legislation that is going through the Congress and the Senate, and then to be signed off to give the president. Can you imagine, of all people, President Obama having the sole authority to travel around the world or maybe to send Kerry? Now, I like Kerry because he's a sailor, and I trust sailors, and he's a Navy man. And by God, if there's anybody in the world I trust, it's the Navy and the men who work in the Navy and the women who work in the Navy. I am proud of our Navy. I am proud of all of our military folk. And I don't want to see any harm come to them. And I don't like it when our government lies to them. And I want them to be smart enough to start questioning some of these ridiculous orders that come through that are in complete violation with the Constitution. And I think that's what's happening. And I think that's why they're so nervous, because they know that these higher-ups in our military are taking the oath once again. They already took it once. They're retaking the oath, and they're becoming oath keepers, just like me. And they're questioning orders like, hey, push the button and we're going to nuke Russia. Well, they just arrested that woman. She was young and she was a captain. And they told her to nuke Russia and push the button. And they gave her a code or something. And she didn't push the button because she questioned, because she knew it would have been a first strike. And she's in prison now. I mean, this is insanity, folks. I mean, if you have a military that obeys orders, and I'm saying, well, you know, if it was an order to, you know, mail something to somebody, or an order to do something de minimis, or something that may be involves starting up a military operation against the enemy that's already known, that's one thing. But when nothing is happening around the world, and the president says, push the button and fire a nuke, And you start to wonder, I mean, after all that's happened, and you know they're allowed to lie to you, and she knew that they were allowed to lie to you, how does she know that the president isn't lying to you, to her? And the president wants to put on her conscience the fact that she pushed the button that killed the entire earth, because we're going to be retaliated against, the whole earth is going to explode. Now, I'm saying you need to follow orders, but, you know, when there's no work going on and nothing's shaking and someone tells you to nuke somebody, I think I'd maybe say, or you ask a question like, are you sure? And they say, well, you didn't push the button fast enough. You're going to jail. Oh, bullshit. This needs to be looked into. I demand that you free that woman. Unless there's something I don't know, I demand that you free that woman and you free our other military officers, high up military officers, who question bogus orders that would have done more damage than good. Because these people are smart. And like I said, if it was a matter of they're on the battlefield against a known enemy and they're already in a fight and the president says, do this or that, that's different. You follow orders immediately. But when nothing's happening, you're at peace, and someone says to push a button to start a war, well, I don't know. You know, why doesn't the president push the button? Let this be on his conscience. Then they can run, they and the Senate can run in their rattles. You know, I kind of get the impression that President Obama wouldn't even tell the Senator of the Congress to run down into the rat hole that they dug under Weather Mountain in Virginia. So they can hide when the Russians retaliate, which if I were them, I'd retaliate. I mean, if they fired nukes in my country and killed everybody, I mean, what's he supposed to do? You know, it shouldn't come to this, folks, but that's where we're at. That's why we have to vote every single congressman, every single senator out of power, because it has gotten to this point that they have all earned an F. F for failure. They have failed. None of this should be happening. We should all be living middle-class, happy lives. We should be worrying about what day in the week we're going to be mowing our lawn. That's what we should be worried about. You know what you should be worried about? You know, years ago we used to worry about, oh, you know what? My neighbor has a newer car than I do. Oh, we both have Cadillacs, but his Cadillac has leather interior and mine only has a cloth interior. So I'm jealous. And then there's sort of like a competition between my neighbor and me, or he has the slightly bigger, the model with the slightly bigger engine, and he can accelerate 0 to 60 in 8 seconds, and it takes me 8.5 seconds. So he brags, oh, my car is faster than yours and everything like that. And then I have to say, well, my airplane's faster than your car. I mean, look, there's no end to this. And no matter who you attack around the world, folks, look, the weapons today, the battlefield of today, the modern day battlefield is so deadly that war has almost become obsolete because, I mean, unless you have some kind of trick up your sleeve that nobody's ever heard of, you're gonna take your blows. And that means it's going to come back on the civilian population because we're not talking about guns here. We're talking about ballistic missiles that go up into outer space and they'll be dropping down, or they're going to be flying in low orbit, or they're going to be flying through the atmosphere from in close. They're going to sneak right up to you and they're going to fire a missile that's only going to take a couple of minutes to hit you. And then it's going to completely flatten a 30-mile radius. Not to mention the radionuclides are going to be poisoning the Earth forever. We can't afford to have crazy people in charge right now. People doing things in secret when the world is at stake. No. I won't allow it. President Obama lied when he said that he was going to have an open government and it was going to be sunshine and transparency. Well, what the hell is this then? This Trans-Pacific thing. So secret that nobody can see it. No one's allowed to read the whole thing all in one piece. It has to be seen page by page. In a secret room, and you have to leave your cell phone behind. It can't be good. I mean, if you were going to buy a business and you were going to expend a lot of time, money, and the rest of your life, you're going to invest in this business, and the seller said, sign the agreement of sale. And you're looking at the thing and it's like 35 or 40 pages long when it really only needs to be maybe 3 or 4 pages long. And then he says, well, you're only allowed to read one page at a time, and you're only allowed to read it if you come to my office and you go into the conference room and we lock the door, and you're not allowed to photocopy it, and you're not allowed to talk about it. It's a trade secret. I'd have to think, is this going to be good for the people? Is this going to be good for me? Because I'm buying the business. I don't know. I think maybe I'd want my lawyer to see it. I'd want my wife to see it because she's going to be, if not directly helping me or a partner in ownership in a thing, she's going to have to deal with whether it turns out good or bad. And she's smart, so she may want to know what's going on and what I'm going to be doing for a living for the rest of my life as I buy an existing business away from someone who wants to sell their business. Look, folks, the government should not be involved in negotiating these things. These are matters of business between corporations, domestic corporations doing business with alien corporation. An alien corporation is a corporation that's not based in the United States, in case you didn't know. A foreign corporation it's not a foreign corporation, it's an alien corporation. Foreign corporation is a corporation that's in another state. A domestic corporation would be, like if you live in Florida, I'm dealing with a Florida corporation, that's domestic. Foreign would be if I go to Georgia. An alien would be if I go to Japan. That's what we have here. We have a contract that's going to spell out how our alien business is going to be done. Well, you know, with the advent of the internet, I could simply... If I were the CEO of a corporation and I wanted to sell medication on the wholesale level, I could type into the computer wholesalers in Japan, wholesalers in China, if I wanted to buy the medication over there. Frankly, I think we should make the medication here, unless there's some reason that it just can't be done here, which is another thing. There shouldn't be any reason why we can't do almost anything here. Think about that for a minute. You know, why should we have to get all our stuff from overseas? But even if we do, why should the government at this point, when we know that everything literally that is made can be made cheaper overseas, thus putting all of our American workers out of work, our white-collar guys, blue-collar guys, and put all of them out of work? Because, you know, everything that we use every day, including this camera that I'm talking to you through, made out of, you know, made somewhere else. Made in a foreign, by a foreign corporation. That's right. Wouldn't be so bad if it were a domestic corporation. But these are alien corporations. So they're not domestic. Not even foreign. They're alien. So you're dealing with alien corporations. But then I could sign whatever deal I want. And if I screw up, because I'm trying to import something that the people need in the United States. Let's say there's a genuine need for thyroid medication in the United States. But nowhere in the United States is thyroid medication made. There's probably a law against it. But let's just say it can't be made here for some reason. I'll fix that real fast. But so if I screw up because I'm the corporation that's trying to import the goods from another country, and I sign a crappy deal, by not having a trade agreement, another company up the road from me can say, well, I can get a better deal than them, my corporation. We're going to import the thyroid medication for half price. We're not going to sign that crap that Ben Cola signed. We're going to sign something even better. Well, if you have a Trans-Pacific, whatever it is, everything's already prearranged and nobody's going to be able to negotiate with anybody except the guy who made the bad deal in the first place. You won't be able to go around him, otherwise you're going to be circumventing it, and I'm sure there'll be some kind of law against that. So now you've got laws that are going to lock out all the hard workers, and no matter how smart you are or how much college education you have, that just makes you dumber. Because now you've got the bill to pay for your education because you've got your student loan. And you're smart. And maybe you learned chemistry as part of your credentials when you went to college. And you're smart enough to make the medication right here. But you have to import it from the mob boss of the North, or the mob boss of the West, or the mob boss of the East, just like in Chicago, or you have to pay him a cut of the action. Wouldn't it be better to know that the other pharmacy up the road, if CVS cuts a bad deal with the people who make the thyroid medication in Japan, that the other pharmacy up the road can call up a different country that makes the same medicine and make another deal and start all over again. They're not tied to one oligarch. That's a monopoly, first of all. See, we're going to enforce these monopoly laws, antitrust violations. Oh, yeah, boy, I'm going to keep the FBI. That's one of the agencies I'm going to keep. And they're going to be investigating these people that are just getting too big for their britches. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's called racketeering. Yeah, I'm going to tell you a funny story about racketeering. You know, it's funny, these big corporations can get away with it, but when I was in the insurance business in New Jersey, I'll never forget this. The cost for labor to fix your automobile was $23 and so many cents an hour. And no matter where you went, the body shop would charge you $23 and so many cents an hour. And there was a really, really good body shop owned by a fella who was just the nicest guy in the world. And I just love this fella. And I referred business to him when I could. But the customers could go wherever they wanted. That's the beauty of it. But once I made the introduction to this guy, they usually liked him and he repaired the car. If anything went wrong, they would call me and I'd call, his name was Richie. I'd call Richie up and I'd say, "Yo, Richie, would you mind polishing out Joe Schmo's bumper a little bit better or redoing the paint job on the front hood or something?" And he would listen to me because I gave him business. But the bottom line is one day, let me first tell you how the rates got to be the way they are. The insurance companies didn't want to pay as the rates, because there was a lot of inflation with respect to your premium. And that led to, well, you go back to my show one, I'll tell you about the inflation, how the rates were going up and up and up in the state of New Jersey. The politicians were going to get voted out of office because the rates were rising and they didn't want the rates to rise. Every time the car insurance rates would rise, the local politicians would get voted out of office because they were so angry about the car insurance prices going up. And it was mandatory that you had it, so you couldn't escape. But it was the whole thing was a fascist setup. You know, we were stuck with this New York organization, and that's what this TPP thing's going to be like, just like the old JUA from New Jersey or the auto insurance plan from New Jersey, where you've got one guy in charge. But anyway, getting back to the price, they even rigged the price to fix your car. You know how they did it? They formed an organization called the Insurance Services Office, also known as the ISO. We just called it ISO for short in the insurance business. See, none of these other guys running for president know any of this stuff. I mean, I know they might be nice people, but they don't know what time it is. You know, I'm your best choice. But anyway, here's what they did. The insurance companies, to get around the monopoly aspect of the cost of labor to fix your car, they created this book, and the book spelled out how much money should be paid to fix this or to fix that. It was kind of like if you're not in the insurance business and you're a mechanic or even just an ordinary person who at one point or another had to have your car fixed, you go to the mechanic and the mechanic has a great big book and he says, "Well, I put a new water pump in," and he's looking at page 5,280. The price for labor to fix a water pump is XYZ, and they use the book. In other words, the mechanic isn't thinking in his head, "Well, I have a special tool, or I know how to change out that water pump in 30 minutes instead of 3 hours, like the book says, and so I'm willing to do it for less." But no, they always refer to the book. Well, the insurance companies did the same thing. They had the ISO book, and they had the so everybody was charging the same price for labor, and the insurance company wouldn't pay a penny more than that for labor. So if your car got wrapped around a tree and it cost 300 hours to fix, it would be 300 hours times $23 an hour in labor, plus the parts that the mechanic needed to put into the car, because you have the parts and then the labor to install the parts. And that's really all there is to fixing the car. And then there was a disposal fee, and then there was a couple of other fees, or sort of like flat fees that, you get the gist of it. But one day, the FBI, can you believe it, showed up at Richie's auto body shop down the road from my place. You know, and he called me up and he was like, "Ben, I can't believe it. He said, but the FBI showed up and they flashed badges and they went through my shop and they had their guns and all this and scared the daylights out of me. And they said that they're going to throw me in prison. He said, they almost put me in jail. And I said, what for? And he said, well, because I charged $23 an hour. Someone had complained that the bill was $23 an hour, while the ISO book said it was $23 an hour to fix the car. And the customer had gone to three or four body shops because they were looking for the cheapest body shop to fix the car. I think in this case, they didn't have insurance. They only had liability, and it was their fault, so they had to pay for their own collision damage. So they had a couple of $1,000s worth of damage, so they were looking, shopping for the best price. So Richie looked it up, and he said, well, it was $23 in the ISO book, and when I charged him $23, the customer went down the road, and then he went down the road the other way, and you get the point. But everybody was charging $23, so the customer filed a complaint with the Better Business Bureau, and then he filed a complaint with somebody else, and it ended up being a Justice Department investigation. Can you imagine? They opened up a Justice Department investigation because the guy was charging the same price. Well, that's what the insurance company would have paid, and that's what the book said. And you know what the FBI said they were going to throw him in prison for? They said he was price fixing. And there's a law against price fixing. Are you kidding me? Price fixing? Well, the insurance companies fixed the price. The body shop didn't fix the price. The insurance companies fixed the price. Now, I don't know what would have happened if suppose he just said $22 an hour. And he might have got in trouble for something else, for violating the usual and customary rates or something. I don't know. I mean, we don't have capitalism in this country. Now, nothing happened to the body shop guy that I mentioned in the end. But the bottom line is, can you imagine? I mean, he was SWAT team raided because he was charging the same price as the insurance company said they were supposed to charge. And that the customer was angry because they got the same price from every auto body shop. See, I think that the insurance companies, in an effort to form a third company for the purposes of writing a book, like a Shilton book, as to how much it should cost to fix your water pump, or in the case of an auto body wreck, how much it should cost labor for a dented fender or this or that. That's how the insurance companies got around price fixing. Because the insurance companies, when the FBI went to the insurance companies, they just said, oh, well, we just used the ISO book. Well, they made the ISO book. They all got together and they made the ISO book. But guess who got SWAT team? Not the insurance company. The auto body shop owner. And he didn't make a lot of money. He lived in a little house. He wanted to get married. He said he didn't have enough money to get married. I mean, he was busy, but he didn't make a lot of money, all said and done. He was just an ordinary guy. He was a middle class. He was in the middle class, that's all. But he almost got thrown in jail for price fixing. So the TPP, it's the same thing. You're fixing, you're rigging it. Not only are you going to be rigging the price, but you're putting one guy in charge. As soon as you're putting one guy in charge of a this or one guy in charge of a that, I don't care if he's in charge of light bulbs. I mean, how would you like it if you picked up the phone and you said, no one's allowed to make a 100-watt light bulb unless it goes through Ben Cola. Now, it can be sold at Lowe's. It can be sold at Home Depot. The light bulb could be sold at Walmart. But Walmart, Lowe's, and Home Depot, they have to get the light bulb from Ben Cola. Well, I wouldn't have to run for office. Oh, yes, I would. Because you know what? It's not about that. It's about me trying to fix things. That's just an example of what needs to be fixed. If someone said, I'm going to put you in charge of all the light bulbs and you're going to become a millionaire, Ben, don't worry about running for president. I'd say, that's not the point. The point is, it shouldn't be like this. I'm running for office because I want to fix this crap. Really, I'd like to retire, but I'm the only guy that knows how to fix it. I'm the only guy that's aware of what's going on and how bad it is and how to link what's going on with how to fix it and how to prove what's going on is illegal. Because they're going to say, oh, it's just a normal trade deal. No, it's not. It's fascism. And with respect to the military, it's militarism. That's what the Chinese and the Russians are calling it, militarism. Now, everything they tell you, it's a lie, and it's the opposite. And the whole thing is just so screwed up. I mean, we get to the point where, even if the Pacific trade thing passes, if it were to have passed yesterday and the president were to land on his desk today, and let's say he signed it today, and then is a free-for-all, and the president goes out and he says, okay, all his best friends are in charge. This guy's in charge of light bulbs. This guy's in charge of thyroid medicine. This guy's in charge of your heart medication. This guy's in charge of all toothpaste. Any kind of imported toothpaste has to go through Mr. Toothpaste Oligarch. I mean, come on. The world is to the point now where, you know, I can see 50 years ago, maybe that could have been a sort of a help without the oligarch part where the price is not negotiable later after he gets the object from overseas. The government is not supposed to be in the position of putting this guy in charge of the light bulbs or this guy in charge of the toothpaste. You see, I mean, that's how we got to where we are today. You know, you can't walk down the sidewalk. I mean, you have to wear a shirt. You have to wear a certain kind of shoes, or you have to have this, or you have to do that. In New Jersey, you can't pump your own gasoline. Are you kidding me? It's too dangerous to pump your own gasoline in New Jersey. You'd think by now New Jersey would say, well, the other 49 states are pumping their own gas. Nobody got killed. I could think of plenty of other things that are more dangerous than pumping your own gasoline. Gassing out the poor kid that's got to pump gas to everybody in the state of New Jersey, breathing in all the fumes. See, what I think's happening right now is in Washington, they finally legalized marijuana. And these guys are alcoholics, so now they're smoking pot and they're drinking their alcohol while they're running the country as a fascist, communist dictatorship here. It's fascism is what it is. And it's a monopolistic, warmongering, Nazism. And we do not need, in the direct quotes of the leaders of Russia and China, we are not interested in rehabilitating Nazism or rehabilitating militarism. It's enough. World War II was enough. They had enough. You know, they had the big parade the other day over the finalizing the win over Germany in the war. And they had the big parade, as you know. Well, guess, and it was in Red Square. And guess who was there? Well, the leader of China was there. And it wasn't only him. I mean, if you looked up there in the skybox, I mean, President Putin was there with many Chinese faces. I mean, they're easy to recognize. I mean, you can see the eyes. China and Russia now are like this. We can't win a war against them. I mean, we could probably put a hurting on them if we wanted to, but why would we want to do that? What the hell did they ever do to us? China bought all our bonds when we needed them to. They want to sell us solar panels for a low price. To me, that's a gift. I say we're taking advantage of them by getting those solar panels for a lower price because a solar panel is going to produce electricity. They're giving us cheaper electricity. We should make money by installing those solar panels in each and every home in the United States. And we should take those solar panels and say, you know what? Ha! We got the better of them on that deal. But no. President Obama put a 15% tariff on them because they were selling solar panels too cheap. For heaven's sake. That's like saying the Chinese are selling us electricity at a cost that's too low. If I can get electricity at a 15% discount, I'm going to take it. And now we have to pay a 15% tax to get the solar panel because Obama said, this is unfair that they can make a solar panel. With me running the show, not right away, but eventually we're going to make a solar panel and it's going to be even 15% lower than it was before. And I don't want there to be a race to the bottom. I mean, I know people have to earn money, but for God's sakes, you know, when you're charging the people of the United States 15% more for a solar panel, which is their way to make electricity, or how about a battery? Let's say the Chinese and Japanese can make a battery for half price. Battery is a big part of a solar panel off-grid house. If they can make battery for half price, what's Obama going to do? Put a 50% tax on batteries? Then what? Then now we got to pay a 50% extra to get the battery and 15% extra to get the solar panel. I say we're ripping them off, and that's good. If you want to hurt the Chinese and you don't like them anymore, I say you steal the solar panels from them for a 15% discount. Well, and it's not even a 15% discount. You take advantage of them on the deal. You need a salesman running this place, running this country. Someone who can convince these people that, hey, you keep giving us the solar panels for a discount and we'll keep buying. But look, you don't need a trade pact that's going to lock us in, because what happens if Vietnam starts making solar panels and they're even cheaper than the Chinese solar panels, and now we can go to Vietnam and we can buy it for even less than China? Instead of putting a tariff on there, then we go down to Vietnam and we rip off Vietnam by getting the solar panels cheaper. To me, getting solar panels cheap is like ripping them off. You're ripping off whoever's giving them to you, because you're taking advantage of them. It's like the great train robbery. And with a smile on their face, they're saying, here, buy these solar panels. I tested them. They're just as good as the solar panels made here. Look, folks, I'm saying that the government, the federal government of the United States, is involving. I'm talking now about why I would be a better leader than the people that you saw that introduced themselves in an effort to get the GOP nomination in the Carolinas just a couple of days ago, because I wasn't there. So this is my answer. I want to do away with the Department of Education. I mean, that is another boondoggle. And the core, that whole core education thing. No. I think that we have enough college graduates now that we all know what time it is, and different states even have their own way of thinking. So it's not just that if they don't have the core education that maybe they're going to learn something that you don't want them to learn. See, I want all the kids to be open-minded. When they come out of college, the only thing I want college to teach them, unless they're specializing in something, but the only thing I want college to really focus on is to teach these kids how to think and how to think out of the box. And that's what I am. See, I am an out-of-the-box thinker. I come from a family of think tank engineers. Do you know what a think tank is? That's where you get a bunch of smart guys in a room, and they try to think of new ways to do old things. Yeah, that's what we need. We need somebody who has the genes, the genetic makeup, to think out of the box. My Uncle Rudy invented the flat screen television set. He has 23 patents. That's my father's brother. And my father invented the phased array radar, which is the heart and soul of the Aegis NAS class destroyer. Now, years ago, that was all top secret, but Russia has this technology now today, so it's not secret. And my father worked in RCA, and there was, after they got going on this thing and got contracted with the Navy, they built a mock-up of a battleship right on dry land. It's in Morristown. It's right off of I-295. You can drive down there and photograph it when you drive by. And they have these big white balls all over the place that are maybe a mile away from the mock-up battleship that's just sitting there built on dry land. Where the building used to be, they made it look like a bridge of a battleship. But what they were doing is they have mock warfare, electronic warfare. And instead of sending the ship out into the ocean, which cost a lot of money, they were able to electronically replicate a naval engagement. And then they could prove that their Aegis class system would work. Sadly, my father one day was at dinner time. He was very despondent, and he said, you know, after it was revealed that they were coming out with a new kind of radar thing, after it was revealed that the Aegis class thing was revealed, he said that one day the thing was going to go berserk and shoot down an innocent person or an innocent airplane. And about 10 years later, the Iranian Airbus got blown out of the sky. All those people died. And what happened then? We had to pay a payoff. We had to pay all those people for the deaths of their family members and friends. How sad. Those people lost their lives because of what my father said was going to happen, because they left it in the automatic mode. Now, when the Donald Cook sailed through the Black Sea and it got buzzed by the Russian fighter jets with the Kabini box or whatever, go back. I already talked about this. Go back and look at the earlier shows. They turned off the Aegis thing on purpose because they could have shot it down before it got there, but they wanted to listen to this thing. That's all I want. Listen to my earlier show. There's nothing wrong with the Aegis class destroyer. They could blow anything out of the sky, even at a low orbit. So when those sailors resigned, well, because they were afraid that the destroyer wasn't defending itself or wasn't capable, and I guess that was the first time anybody told the sailors that, hey, these Russians have technology too, which leads me to my next bullet point that I want to make here. This whole, going up against them on their home field advantage in Ukraine is going to be a losing proposition. If I were the president, I wouldn't get involved. Because first of all, you have to think about the humans here, the human toll on life. I mean, they want to become Russian. They were a member of this ex-old Soviet Union. And after the wall fell, they became independent. They weren't part of the EU. They weren't part of the Soviet Union. They were just Ukraine. And after decades of just being Ukrainians, they made a conscious decision to hold a vote allowable under the UN. The right of the people shall not be infringed to self-determination. And that overrides the other lines in the UN Charter that say, talk about contiguous boundaries and stuff. When you're talking about the rights of the individual people, have the right to self-determination, that's an overriding clause as far as I'm concerned. I'm not a lawyer, but I would say if I looked at that and I were the judge, I would say the people have the right to self-determination. And that's telling me that the people have a right to change their borders if they want to. That's my take on it. If I'm in power, that's the way it's going to be. And so those people had many, many decades to just think about it. Hey, was I better off in the Soviet Union? Was I better off as an independent Ukrainian? Or am I better off going back to Russia now that the wall fell and Russia is not communist anymore? They're more capitalistic than the United States, and we're fascist and they're capitalist. Isn't that funny? No, it's not funny. Now, so I'm going to do away with it. I'm going to do away with the DEA, and I'm reminding you, going back to that bullet point we just talked about, I would not get into a fight over the Ukraine and the Crimea because they voted. And to call those people terrorists and then let Chocolate Man arm him up and the lies, the never-ending lies coming out of Washington, what a mess. You know, I drove by Washington about a month ago from the highway. I looked over at it and I thought, man, this place looks dirty and scummy. Yeah, the roadways all crumbling and falling apart. The bridges aren't painted. The signs are all in the wrong place. Your GPS doesn't work right, by the way, either when you go into Washington. I don't know if they have jammers or something, but every time I go through Washington, my GPS doesn't work right. That's probably why that girl got lost and why they had to shoot her to death with the kid in the car. Oh, and then the Congress. You remember the afternoon the girl got shot to death about 6 months ago because she got lost in Washington, D.C. and she was near the Capitol. And the police were chasing her and scared her to death. She was in the car with her kid. Yeah, real danger. She didn't have a gun or a weapon. They shot her right through the car. Wasn't like she was outside the car. She wasn't even shaking her fist at the police. She was lost. You telling me they couldn't have captured her? Even if she was mentally ill. Maybe she was. Maybe that's why she backed up and she was trying to run away. But she was trying to run away. And what did they do? They shot her. How many times? Oh, but the kid didn't die. they rescued the child. God knows where the child is now. But then in the Congress that afternoon, they all stood up and they cheered the police. Yeah, you get him, man. You killed that bad lady. So sad. You guys all need to go, okay, to cheer the shooting death of a woman who may have been mentally ill, may have been on bipolar medication. She was lost. Maybe her GPS, like mine, doesn't work right when you're in Washington because for security reasons, they scramble the signal there. They do it to me. I got lost last month when I drove by, missed my turn. And I was lost for an hour, and I was on the main highway. But to shoot somebody like that and for the Congress to cheer out that was a good thing. And they did. They all cheered. I saw it right on national TV. All saw it. Yay! The tough police officer shot a mother to death through her car. Listen, folks, these people are pure evil. They're pure evil. Now, maybe they didn't have anything to do with the fact that the TPP or whatever is completely private and no one's allowed to see it. That might have come from, well, whoever wrote the bill obviously must have said it would be better if the congressman can't see it. But as soon as they start talking like that, you can't see it and you have to sign it right away and you can't copy it and all, then you know something bad's about to happen. I'm just telling you from experience in the insurance business. And that's what the insurance company does to you. As an insurance adjuster, I can tell you right now, you know, you're told to go down there and make them an offer and hope they'll go away, make them a low-ball offer. Say, well, I'm going to pay you right now if you take $1,200 on a claim that might be $5,000. So you say, well, I give them $1,200 right now because they need money. Or if you don't pay it right away, you wait until they're hard up for money and you hang out a lowball offer and just wait for months and months and months until they finally, somebody tells them, well, I have a car that's worth $6,000. I want to sell it for $3,000. And so they want to buy the car for $3,000. So they go ahead and they accept the offer if the insurance company made them on their accident claim. They should be settling for $10,000. They had an offer of $3,000, and they take the $3,000 because they can buy a car cheap. And the insurance company stands to gain because they didn't settle. But by law, they're supposed to settle within 30 days. But they don't. And who's going to enforce the law? Well, I will. As your leader, what I see happening are antitrust violations. Violations of monopoly. That's how these oligarchs are getting rich. And that's why Obama yesterday had to say, these hedge fund managers. Well, you know, who put them in that position of being the only hedge fund managers? Why aren't there more hedge funds? And by the way, I don't think you should be allowed to run a hedge fund unless whatever you're hedging, you have the actual right to purchase. Because anybody could draw up a contract that said, I'm going to sell you gold for $800 an ounce, sign here and give me $50, and you have 30 days for you to turn your claim in. But I only have to settle in dollars. Well, you can make an infinite amount of money. You're running a gambling casino. That's what it is. It's a gambling casino. You have turned our financial institutions into gambling casinos. No wonder the Trump Casino Hotel went bankrupt, because you can gamble on the derivatives. It's gambling. You don't have to go to Atlantic City or Las Vegas to gamble anymore. You just go to the bank and you can gamble all you want. No, I'm going to stop that crap right away. If you don't hold the asset and can prove it, and it has to be auditable, and our Securities and Exchange Commission, I'm going to keep that going. Well, I'm not going to do away with the SEC, and it's going to be auditable. And you better have the gold. If you're selling gold, puts or calls and options, you better have the gold, the physical gold. And you're not going to be allowed to put on the fine print of a derivative contract, we have the right to settle in dollars and not in the actual item. Well, that's the purpose of a derivative contract, so you can buy the actual item. So that's the difference between me and the other people that are vying for the nomination for the GOP. And frankly, I'd like to be in on the GOP, but I don't care. I'm going to run because somebody has to clean this mess up. And I haven't heard anything from anybody that knows what to do. They don't even know what's happening, let alone know how to fix it. I have answers to all of these problems, how to correct everything. And by the way, Governor Bush, Jeb Bush, nicest guy in the world. I love the guy. Jeb Bush is one hell of a nice dude, really. He's a nice guy. And I think he's the best of the Bush family. I really do. I voted for Bush. I was a member of the GOP. I felt obligated to vote for him because of that. But I thought he would do was doing the best job at the time. But you know what? I would not have invaded Iraq. And Jeb Bush yesterday, oh my God, on national TV, it was right on NPR as I was driving home from shopping yesterday. And I had one of those, what they call a driveway moment, where they were talking about it. And Jeb Bush came on the air and they were interviewing him. And then they asked him, they said, what would you do if you were, what would you have done if you were the president when the World Towers got knocked down? Would you have invaded Iraq? And he said, yes, I would. Given the intelligence I had, I would have. And then he followed it up by saying, and Hillary Clinton, by the way, supported it because, you know, we all supported it. Well, now, just a minute here. Just a minute here. Let's try and remember. Let's go back. When the World Trade Centers got knocked down, it was announced widely on the news that they knew who did it. Osama bin Laden. They knew where he was. He was in Afghanistan. So why did they invade Iraq? They had Saddam Hussein there. They just didn't like him. And he was selling oil. He started to sell oil to Europe in euros. And of course, they really didn't like that because he was bypassing the dollar. But Jeb Bush himself said that he would have invaded Iraq. And I can still see with my my eyes and in the back of my head, just like as if the movie were running, as if it were going right now, the bombs falling. Remember the shock and awe? Boy, that was really cool. Shock and awe. They bombed downtown Baghdad with the civilians. They told them to stay in place as they dropped these 2,000-pound bombs on them, killing children, women, men that had nothing to do with it. They didn't even know what the hell was happening to them. They didn't know anything. None of them had ever seen the World Trade Center. None of them had ever been to New York. And they didn't know anything about the Taliban. They had nothing to do with it. But the shock and awe, well, we destroyed and bombed downtown Baghdad. If Saddam Hussein was still in power, you wouldn't have all the baloney going on now. Millions of people ran for their lives to Jordan as that thing rolled out. They were supposed to be being fed under the oil for food program, which we were welching on that too. So I guess he thought, well, I'll sell some of my oil to Europe. Now, Europe's not our enemy. They're supposed to be our allies. So why care about that? Well, you know, I know they get very, very, very touchy when it comes to selling oil in a currency other than the dollar. But you're talking about killing off a whole city. And then they end up catching him and make Trump up a bunch of charges, things that he did that probably wouldn't have happened if the war hadn't started. I guess he did some things after the war started because he had to. So, I mean, they can make up a bunch of stories, and next thing you know, they hang him. Couldn't put him in jail for the rest of his life, so in case they change his mind, they could let him out. And what would have happened, you know, if it happened the other way? And Saddam Hussein had the big Air Force, and he had the shock and awe against Washington, and the bombs fell, and then they came over, and then they captured President Bush and trumped up a bunch of charges. Even though President Bush was keeping al-Qaeda at bay, there were no terrorists, there were no weapons of mass destruction, there was no al-Qaeda. He was hard on the terrorists. He kept that whole place running smooth. Now it's a free-for-all. I guess the only good thing about it is they all, you know, the Sunnis and the Shias have always wanted to kill each other. The only thing good about it is now, I guess, they're getting the chance to kill each other while we sort of, for the most part, are sitting on the side. while they kill each other. I guess the only good you could say about it is they're finishing off their differences once and for all, getting it over with. It shouldn't have happened in the first place. I mean, you've got all these people displaced. They used ammunition now that irradiated the whole country. This is terrible. And now for Jeb Bush, even with the information that he has, to go back and say, yeah, I would have done it. Something tells me he would do it again today if he had the chance. So here we go again. Are you going to let this guy who has had a good career, has a good name? He was the governor of the state of Florida for 2 terms. This man should be fishing every day. He should be enjoying his life and his family. Why does he need to run for president? I'll tell you why. These people go round and round, office to office to office to office, because you know why? They want to be the oligarch in the Trans-Pacific trade agreement. That's right, because if they're in charge, then they get to put their name on and become the oligarch of the light bulbs, and the oligarch of the thyroid medication, and the oligarch of the heart medication, and the oligarch of any other kind of thing that we need. And then everything that's coming into the country goes through their wholesale company. Well, it might not be in their name, but trust me, they've got stock in the company. Just like Halliburton. I mean, the Bushes knew that Halliburton was going to make a fortune on the war. So, gee, it was in his best interest to start up a war. I mean, I'm sure he made money out of it. He must have owned stock in the company. So now you have to wonder, you know, all these people that got killed, was it worth it? Well, I guess so, if you don't have a conscience and you don't care. The whole thing is unstable right now. And, you know, we provided the heavy artillery that they used to fire on the Gaza Strip against the Palestinians. The kids were throwing rocks. When I was a kid, I threw snowballs. I mean, come on. So the Israelis have to shoot back at them with these howitzers, with semi-nuclear shells. And then they hit the UN building, killing over 100 people. And when they were told about it, they withheld fire for about 30 minutes until they thought about it. And they thought, screw them, let's keep shooting. And then they continued shooting at the school. These people are all insane. When Benjamin Netanyahu came over, Benjamin Netanyahu, I've got to give you credit. I mean, he's bilingual and he's an excellent orator. He's a good salesman. So am I. But he makes a good argument for the sake of Israel. I guess if someone's going to come to the United States to talk to the United States about helping Israel, it should be Benjamin Netanyahu, because, I mean, we couldn't understand anybody else if he wouldn't be speaking English. Wouldn't be as good of a speaker. But you know what? It's not what he says, it's what he did. And what he did was murder, genocide. He didn't have to do that bombing on the Gaza Strip. It's so sad. I mean, I would say it's funny, but it's so sad. You know, that when they gave the Gaza Strip and the rights to the Palestinians, they were only allowed to go out in their boat 3 miles. Being a fisherman, I'm thinking to myself, well, I'm allowed to go out in the ocean at least. Now they gave me oceanfront property, the Gaza Strip, and they gave my land back. But I'm not allowed to go out in the ocean past 3 miles. That's what the deal was, 3 miles. But how are you going to catch a fish 3 miles out in the ocean? You're not going to be able to catch certain kinds of fish, I suppose you can catch, but not all the fish. And sometimes a certain kind of fish that you do catch inland are usually further out than 3 miles. Or the bigger fish that may be more in demand are further out than 3 miles. So if I give you land, I give you your land back, it should have been yours in the first place, and then I say, I am the god of the ocean, and you can't go out in your fishing boat more than 3 miles. First of all, who gave him the rights to the ocean? You know, the ocean is international. Nobody owns the ocean. And I won't let anybody own the ocean if I'm running things. Oh, no. I'm going to make sure anybody who starts making claims on the ocean is going to go bye-bye. I won't sign up for anything that dictates who owns the ocean. And I'm not going to allow any other country. I'll do all I can as an American and with my ambassadors to stop any claims of ownership of the ocean. Now, we can negotiate for mineral rights and that kind of thing because, I mean, somebody's got to dig it out of the ground. But it should be more of a shared thing. But right now, the way things are going, I mean, you're going to have wars starting up over oil that's under the ocean now that we have the technology to withdraw, to actually harvest the oil that is under the sea, where years ago we couldn't harvest the oil under the sea. I mean, suppose they strike gold somewhere and it's out in the ocean and they find a gold mine under the ocean. I mean, stranger things have happened. Strange things happen in Washington every day. But yeah, the price of gold, they say, is going to go up and up and up and up. The dollar is going to fall. Well, cut me a break. The dollar is not going to fall. It's going to go up. It's going to go down. The brick or no brick, the dollar is a dollar. And it's going to be acceptable in the United States, even if the rest of the world hates us. You know, because I'm a true constitutionalist. I'm a patriot. And I know that this country, as long as it's not mismanaged, as it is now and has been, we have enough land to harvest all the food we need at a low price. We have our own oil right here, so it doesn't matter how angry the rest of the world gets. We have the water, fresh water, so we don't even have to take water. And if we have to, we could take water out of the ocean and desalinate it. And we have enough water in the ocean to desalinate enough water to water everything. Because two-thirds of the ocean, two-thirds of the world is the ocean. So you could withdraw water from the ocean if you had to make water for California. If it comes down to that's what you need to grow your crops and there's nowhere else to get it. See, now I have a really good idea right now. They're talking about, the Everglades. Well, the oligarchs are fighting right now over who owns the land in the Everglades. That's what this whole thing in Florida is going on right now about the land. Because whoever owns the land, it's under the water, it's submerged land. If it rains hard, they measure how many inches of water are on your land. And then there's going to be a charge that the state, this is how they want to rig it up, folks. This is how corrupt, even at the state level, it's getting. They want to rig it up where the person who owns the land that years ago would have been, they would have said, if you're a real estate broker and you're selling land and it's underwater land, watch out that you buy underwater land. That bad real estate guy is selling you land. It's wet land and it's not worth anything. Well, now, if the land has water on it, guess what? You get to charge the state of Florida a rental fee because the rain fell on your land and you're storing it. Because they're saying, well, we have to get our water somewhere, so the water lands on your property, so you have possession of the water while it's on your property, do you not? So are you entitled to a storage fee for the water? Water comes out of the sky, it's kind of like an act of God. I mean, nobody can stop it from coming out of the sky. It lands on your land. You didn't pay much for it years ago because it was deemed not buildable. It was just wetlands. But now if you own it, you're rich. Because guess what? You get to charge the state of Florida money. Now, if I were the state of Florida, I'd say, screw you. That water's going to be there whether you like it or not. Why should the state of Florida people of the state of Florida be on the hook to pay rental fees to the oligarch who owns the Everglades, which is semi-submerged property? So right now they're fighting and arguing about who owns the land. Oh, God. I mean, how low have we gone? Water should be, when I'm in charge, I'm going to make sure that water is damn near free because it comes out of the ground, at least in Florida, for nothing. The electricity to pump it, and you can get that for free from the sun. Aside from the infrastructure to harvest the sunlight, turn it to electricity, and pump it out of the ground. But that's not that much money in the whole scheme of things. And they want to shut the water off in Detroit to those poor people. It was in the news yesterday. I guess the UN held them up for 6 months or so when they filed a complaint 6 months ago about them shutting the water off, claiming that it was a human right. They're going to shut it off anyway. But you know what? The bill shouldn't be that high. So they should easily be able to pay the water bill. because there's no water shortage in Detroit. Where is Detroit? It's right on Lake Michigan. You drill a hole in the ground, the water comes out. What you got to do is pump it out of the ground. So why should they worry about shutting it off? You should be able to dig the water out of the ground yourself for nothing, but you're probably not allowed to grow. It's like around here, I guess you're not allowed to have a well. Hey, hammer a nail in the ground or something, and you're in violation of the law, you're not allowed to have a well. You know why you can't have a well? Because the oligarch has to charge you for the free water that he's going to charge you for, but that you could get for free. See, I don't think the government should be in your face like that. You're going to be free, and you own the land. You're going to own what's under the land. If you suck the water out of the ground for nothing, then guess what? It's your water. You withdrew it yourself. You expended your time and your energy and your effort, and you were industrious enough to get the water to come out of the ground, and it's now in your possession. It always was in your possession. It was under your property, 6 feet down. Under my house, the water table's all 6 feet deep. I could drill a hole 6 feet down and put a PVC pipe and suck the water out of the ground and have all the water I want. Now, to me, I'm like, well, you know, there's some benefit to paying the water company, because with the water, you get trash collection. That's the only thing that stops me from putting that, and the fact that it's illegal to put a well in without a permit. It probably costs, I didn't even investigate because to me it wasn't worth it. But with that, you get trash removal and you get your waste, and I didn't want to have to put a septic system in. So to me, it was worth it. But you get the drift. One person could drill a well, as I see it, and service the whole community. Because one well, it could service 20 houses. And you know, why should it be at the municipal level? Why shouldn't it be at the homeowners association level? Or two or three city blocks get together and they say, oh, let's go to Bill's house. And Bill's house has the highest water table. We're going to have an artesian well put down. It's going to cost $2,000 to have it professionally installed. And then we're going to hook that up to the pipe that goes everywhere. And then no one's going to have a water bill. Oh, we ought to kick in a dollar for electricity to run the pump. And if the pump burns, everybody has to pay $2 that month to fix the pump. Not $60 a month. So you see, the cost of living is going to come way down under a Ben Cola administration. And your school isn't going to be dictated to. You're not going to have these responsibilities to teach the core, which is half of it is baloney. And your area may not want to teach that. I mean, if the government can lie to you, why should they mandate that you be taught history books that are lies? You know, if you look at these core books, half of it's bullcrap. And it's not the same history that I learned. So they want to change history by forcing the core on you. And then, of course, we have to pay these people for the right, for the benefit for them to push the lies on you. Then, of course, they're in charge of the textbooks, so then they get the oligarch gets a kickback for that. It's fascism, okay? It's no different than the Chicago mobs back in the days of Prohibition, where Mr. North has the north end of town and Mr. South has the south end of town, or whatever. They're sharing in the value of selling cigarettes, or liquor, or protection money. That's what it's come down to. And now they just want to legalize it at the highest level. The United States federal government is not supposed to be doing these trade pact things. They should not block a corporation, a small corporation, or a small Schedule C business or independent proprietorship, sole proprietorship, from picking up the cell phone or going on the internet, logging on, and purchasing the medication from China. That's where it comes from anyway. It comes from Europe and China. Cut out the middleman, the oligarch. Buy it straight from wherever you can get it from over there. Now, the risk is on you. I mean, you're buying a product. You check out who you're buying it from. But that should be on you, not on the government. Because the government isn't going to check anything anyway. I mean, they didn't tell us to take potassium iodide tablets when Fukushima radioactive iodine was coming. They could have told us to stay out of the rain and stay inside. But Obama said flat out, I remember him saying, there is no immediate threat. There's no danger. Well, I was outside in the rain. in the Cocoa Melbourne area. Now we're finding out 2 years later that that was the hardest hit area in the whole United States. Yeah, maybe the world. I don't know. Other than right under the
ground zero.
Yeah, other than the ground zero. Yeah, that's just the way it happened. Other things I want to do away with is going to be look, folks. I want to fix the Internal Revenue Service. The Department of Education. I already told you I was going to do away with that. The whole education is going to be local level. Now let's look at the IRS. We're going to be able to do away with that to the extent that you have to file an income tax return, because of the taxes. I'm not anti-tax. I understand the government needs money to run. I am not anti-tax. I am pro-privacy. And when you fill in that form, that IRS form, you're telling them what your occupation is. You're telling them what your gross receipts are. You're telling them all the purveyors of services to you, because if you write off your office expenses, you start making a list, and you're telling them who you're buying your goods from, and you're giving them so much information that they are building a dossier on you. It's a terrible infringement on privacy. Now, to collect the taxes, which is necessary, without building a dossier, which would be more beneficial and it wouldn't leave that bad taste in your mouth, would be to pay it as a sales tax. Not to mention the fact that you could throw the 5,000-page rule book out the window, and it would be more fair, because when you make a dollar and you spend a dollar, just like gasoline, when you buy gasoline, you pay a federal tax and you pay a state tax. And around here, you pay a local tax, too. I'm pretty sure the county charges a tax, too. So all these taxes are coming out of the sales tax. And the cash register, computer in the cash register, figures this all out. So it doesn't cost the owner of the business a penny. So you see, the same thing can be done with the Internal Revenue Service. And so without revealing all of your identification, without revealing what your occupation is, what you're doing for a living, when you buy something, you pay a 10% extra sales tax for the IRS. But in return for that 10%, you don't have to pay the income tax. Now, if you're in poverty, and people who are impoverished don't pay income tax, so their argument's going to be, well, that's going to be bad for me because I'm impoverished. Well, you would get a special card. It'd be like a food stamp card. Be a little more lenient to get than a food stamp card. And the cash register wouldn't charge you that part of the tax. What about gasoline? I mean, you know, the poor people could make an argument that why should I pay the federal part of the gas tax? If I'm so poor and I don't have to pay income tax, why should I pay the federal part of the gas tax? Right? Makes sense. It's a good question. I think it should be waived on all taxes, including their gasoline bill should be less. Well, the cash registers today are smart, and all they have to do is type in a code. They could download it from a service provider for free as an app, and it would go into their cash register, and it would be anonymous, and then it would just work off the gross receipts. So you see, this can work. And in that way, gasoline would cost less for people who are impoverished because they wouldn't pay the road tax. Why should they? They don't have to pay the IRS. So I say you put that in place, and then you could fire 43 I think there are 43,000 people working for the Internal Revenue Service. You could lay them all off, except for maybe 1,000, and the 1,000 would run the computer system to make sure that the stores, in fact, paid the sales tax in.
They could run the Medicaid program.
Yeah, and then they could run the Medicaid program, which I think the Medicaid program, Medicaid and Medicare, should be expanded. We should do away with Obamacare. It should be replaced with Medicaid and Medicare. It's as simple as that, because under Obamacare, what you have there, once again, is fascism, because you have several companies that are able to, they're the ones who are authorized to sell Obamacare, and the money coming into them exceeds the cost of the payouts that they make for the service. They're actually earning a profit on this, And furthermore, they're guaranteed that if they don't earn a profit, that the government is going to reimburse them. So it's fascism with a guarantee.
Subsidization.
I would do away with that. And because I'm an insurance expert, I could tell you how to do that. And I already wrote numerous essays about how to do it. So trust me, folks, and my fellows that are vying for the nomination have no idea how to reconstruct health insurance. I'm licensed. Hello, I'm licensed in that field and can tell you how to do it very easily and quickly. But we have got to stop this militarism the rehabilitation. What we're doing is we're rehabilitating Nazism. We beat the Nazis in World War II, and now we've got the Nazi-esque mentality in the Western side. I call it the chocolate man side of the Ukraine. And the Eastern people just didn't want to go along with it. They recognized right away. They live with those people. They know they're Nazis. They don't want to be under the thumb of these Nazis. And, you know, we propped up the chocolate man guy. The prior fellow ran to Putin for help, and I guess Putin just didn't help him fast enough before we got our guy in here and propped the chocolate man up. And I understand that subsequently he was elected in, but, I mean, he was the only guy that was on TV 24/7. Nobody knew, there was not an alternative. And I think we need the campaign reform. You need to go back and look at my hovercraft story. It's funny as hell. It tells a story about how creative I was when I was a kid, and I invented, came up to the conclusion that I could use a lawnmower engine and a homemade propeller to fly a hovercraft, including with me sitting on it, down the street. And then the last 30 minutes of the show talks about campaign reform. Maybe I'll separate it and make a separate show out of that. But for now, just go back and watch the second half of the hovercraft story. The first half is funny enough to watch anyway. I'd watch the whole thing, frankly, but also the DEA. Now, the DEA, Drug Enforcement Administration. First of all, we don't want any more enforcement, especially from Washington. You know where the drug enforcement is going to come from? It's going to come from each and every very smart person, because we have all these college graduates now, and most people graduated high school, and you'd have to be pretty smart to graduate high school now, because the curricula is hard enough that by the time you're out of high school, between that and the information you can get from the internet, you're definitely smart enough to research the internet once you get out of high school, and you can read and write quickly. You know basic math, including business math, and between that knowledge, the knowledge of how to run a computer, and the information that you can glean from Google, you could teach yourself any college level study, and you could focus on that. And frankly, to go to college and spend a lot of money, then you have to sort of weigh, well, am I going to get a job because I have this college education, when somebody could come out of high school and study on the internet for 3 months exactly what he's focusing on because of what job opportunity he's confronted with. And he could actually overtake the college graduate and not have the student debt. So you have to count that whole student debt thing into the equation as to whether I'm making a good decision in going to college. And when you go to college, you're frankly being brainwashed by the core, because the college is going to have a core education that they're going to teach you. They've been teaching the same material for 50 years. And as things change and you know, you're not learning anything really new. You're learning the old stuff and the old way, and then some of the new stuff too. But you can get everything, the old and the new, off the internet, and I trust that more in any case. So the DEA is going to be gone bye-bye, and all the budget associated with it, and the Food and Drug Administration. You know what the FDA is doing? When Fukushima hit, and we've got radioactive fish now coming out of the Pacific Ocean. I mean, it's stop avoiding the subject, folks. I mean, maybe I'm the only potential nominee that knows anything about physics, but I had enough college-level physics that I could tell you this is a bad situation. Also, I had many years of weather because I had to take it to get my POTS license and my captain's and my ocean operator's license, captain's license and everything. So I had years of weather training, and I can tell you that the current and the wind is blowing our way straight from Fukushima. So anything bad that's happening there, and it is, it's leaking continuously. And all of that radioactive, all the daughters of radioactivity are coming our way. And we're talking about radionuclides that are going to last for thousands, if not millions of years. And it's coming in the water. And, of course, if it's in the water, it's going to be picked up by the plankton. And the plankton is going to die very quickly because it has a short life. So as soon as that poison in the water hits the plankton, it's going to kill the plankton off. And the plankton is what's making our oxygen. So when they say, recently it was in the mainstream about a month ago, they were saying, the carbon dioxide levels are going up. Oh, my God. Well, guess what? You know, the oxygen levels might be going down because the plankton is dying in the Pacific Ocean. And that's where all the oxygen comes from. Not all of it, but a lot of it. Some of it's coming from the trees, which, of course, the United States bombed the trees in Vietnam, so they don't give a crap about the trees. By the way, we're going to be planting trees. We're going to have a tree drive here for the Marine Customs Services Corporation is going to, and I'm going to be working as an advocate for MCS to plant trees to help resurrect, to absorb the CO2. Into our trees and to help our biosphere, because that tree is going to be putting out oxygen that we need while simultaneously absorbing the CO2. And we found a good supply of oak trees that are about this tall. We found a really, really good supply, and they have good genes. I saw the trees that these little babies are going to turn into, and they're beautiful, and they're big hardwood trees. And we gained access to tens of thousands of these things. And we're going to be planting them in legal places where they're going to be able to grow to full size. And they're going to be taking a lot of these pollutants out of the air and producing oxygen. So for about $10 a tree, we're going to have a drive going to plant these things. And we're going to be planting them by the thousand for $10 a piece. So pretty soon I'm going to be asking you for donations that'll go directly to the tree planting project. And for every $10 you put in, we're gonna plant not a seed, but we're going to plant an oak tree that's already about this big. And I strongly urge you to donate $10 to the cause. Let's see, what else are we gonna do? Well, I think after we get rid of the DEA, and then we don't have to worry about them chasing you down and telling you what drug to take, because your doctor will tell you what drug to take, not the DEA. Screw the DEA. We don't need the DEA telling us what's good for us and what's bad for us, because why? We have a doctor who is smarter than the DEA. Homeland Security, another big boondoggle. You know, we didn't have any Homeland Security years ago. And I never felt like I was in danger except for the Russia. I thought the Soviet Union was going to nuke us at any moment because the air raid siren would go off and we had to duck under our table. Now, I don't know what our other potential nominees for the GOP are saying, because I did hear some of it, and they were talking about the budget, which I have an easy way of handling. Budget, folks, we're going to lower the budget, and it's not going to lower anybody's Social Security check. It's not going to lower any of your benefits, and it's not going to take away your safety net. But I promise you, we will get that budget under control. And in fact, I'm going to have it reversed, and it ain't going to come off of your benefits. And I have a way of doing it. And right now, you know what? I'm not going to tell you how I'm going to do it, but I guarantee you it'll work. And I have a securities license. I know how to make this thing work, and I will make it work, and I have a plan. And if I tell you the plan now, then everybody else is just going to parrot what I'm saying, and it won't set me apart from the others, because I am smarter. Call it an invention, if you will. So I want to keep that information to myself. So I'm telling you now, I have a way to balance the budget and to actually reverse the budget without harming the safety net or taking away your pensions or doing a bank bail-in or anything. That's going to be illegal. We're going to maintain our FDIC insurance, but we're going to remove the FDIC insurance for the derivatives. Derivatives are gambling. It's just like having an insured stock market. If you buy into the stock market and your stock goes down, you can't make a claim and say, my stock went down, and put a claim into FDIC insurance. I mean, that's ridiculous. Now, they do have insurance that says if your broker goes insane and steals the money, then that's a different story. There already is SIPC insurance for that, securities insurance for that. But it doesn't guarantee that your stock is going to go up otherwise, or if you take a loss, that you're going to be reimbursed. No. But if you make an honest deposit into a savings account, a covered savings account that has FDIC insurance, yes, that will stay in place. I will not remove that. Which they removed it now. You don't have the FDIC insurance anymore because the bail-in documents were signed. Oh, that's a secret. You don't know about that, do you? And you don't hear the other potential nominees talking about that. You know why? Because they're so stupid, they don't even know what's going on. The thing was signed in secret, but I caught wind of it, and I know that the bail-in documents were signed. Just like in Greece, you know, if the crap really hits the fan, your bank can give you bank stock and take your deposits away or a percentage of them. Yeah, this is signed off. This is law now. I'm going to repeal that right away. And we need to find out who put this crap in place, and we need to start doing something to these people. And I'm telling you, I stand for the Constitution, and we're going to have mandatory constitutional jail terms, just like right now you have mandatory jail terms for people who are dealing drugs or get caught doing drugs. And where the judge says, sorry, nothing I can do, the difference between me and my fellow nominee hopefuls is that I am going to have mandatory constitutional jail for our public servants. And they shall be called servants because they're not officials. And if a public servant breaches your constitutional rights, it's not going to be one of these things where right now it's a civil matter and it's like, well, you can't do that, and the judge is going to say, we have to let you go because you're arguing in your case that your civil rights were breached, and therefore the illegal search and seizure on your home, it was illegal, and so we're going to have to drop the evidence. No, no, no. Not only are you going to drop the evidence, but the cops are going to go to prison for 10 years for doing it in the first place. Okay, it's not going to be one of these things where it's like an oopsie, and sorry, we're going to have to let the bad guy go. No. If you do something like that to somebody, you're going to go to prison. You're going to become a criminal. And it's not a civil thing. It's going to be a criminal thing. Now, I'm not going to treat ordinary citizens who are not working for the government, but anyone operating under color of law or anyone working for the government who, by the way, is going to have 20 hours of mandatory constitutional education before they're allowed to even take the oath of office. Then they have to take the oath of office. And then if it's violated, mandatory jail terms. You run into somebody's house without a warrant, you're going down for 5 to 10 years. You shoot somebody that you weren't supposed to, make a bad decision, you violated their civil rights, you took away their life. You know, you have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, I already made a show on the pursuit of happiness. Go back and look at show 26? Go back and look at show 26, where you have me pretending to be Mark Anthony and Cleopatra. That's Lee, by the way. You see the picture there on the thumbnail. That's just us at a Halloween party. But I'm pursuing happiness. That's what it's supposed to mean. I'm pursuing her, and she's so beautiful. So that's pursuit of happiness. But it's more than that. It's the pursuit of if I want to smoke marijuana, which I don't, and I'm not known as a pot smoker. But if I wanted to, I wouldn't want to stop anybody else, and I wouldn't want anybody stopping me if I wanted to smoke pot. I mean, it's legal for the President of the United States in Washington, D.C. to smoke pot now. Maybe that's why all these crazy things are happening now, or getting worse, rather. But in any case, so I'm going to do away with the DEA, and I'm going to have mandatory jail terms for these people that are violating your constitutional rights. Oh, and if they try to get around it by getting a warrant to search your home, and we find the same judge, rubber stamp judge, where the same judge is stamping these things, obviously not reading them, and they're just stamping them, we're going to have an algorithm that says, look, if we find the same judge stamping these things over and over again, then we're going to start investigating him because he might be just rubber stamping these things in order to give the police freedom to reign or whatever, or if someone is signing on behalf of the judge, like his secretary. A lot of times judges have your assistant sign with a stamp on court orders and stuff like that. That's going to be, when you're talking about invading somebody's civil rights, it better be the signature of the judge, and that judge is going to go down if he's just signing stuff with a rubber stamp or just signing things without fully understanding the situation. And if he exceeds his quota, then I'm going to have to start up an investigation. And the Justice Department, we're going to retain the FBI. And we're going to have a whole RICO division of the FBI for racketeers. And we're going to be investigating these racketeers. You know what they say, the old adage, behind every great fortune lies a great crime. Well, you know, that's true to a certain extent. It's probably true to a great extent. So, you know, we really need to look into this. Let's see, on my list here.
New definition of unsecured debt.
Yeah, well, like I said, the bank deposits are all going to be secured. Now, with respect to the real estate, the corrections that we're going to make to boost the real estate market, my fellow nominees, the hopefuls, these guys, they haven't been in the real estate business, folks. I ran a real estate office. I was the youngest real estate broker of record in the state of New Jersey. I was told that. I was given a letter by the state. I've been in the real estate business a long, long time, and I've seen every kind of deal there is, and I really have had my ups and downs in the real estate business, as well as insurance. I was in the top five in the number of policies written. Those two businesses sort of go together, to tell you the truth. But my cohorts here that are trying to run for the nomination, they just don't know what to do on these things. But on the FHA and the VA, I'm not going to be so concerned about people's credit report. You know, a tremendous effort, a tremendous waste of time on these credit reports, checking people's credit in order to give them a credit card, or in order to give them, well, maybe for a credit card, but in order to give you a loan for a car or a loan for a house. No, that's not the way it's supposed to work, because you lose your job, and what's going to happen to your credit? It's going down, just like the public servant who violates your civil rights. You can't trust the credit reporting agency anyway, because that could be wrong. But even if you could, the credit report is the only thing that's going up and down here. So as the future comes, year by year, after that man buys the home, and the bank is exposed to the risk of a default, you see, the only thing that is changing as time goes on, besides the price of the house a little bit up, a little bit down, and I think it should be allowed to go up and down, is the man's credit report. Am I off base here or what? I mean, what if the man loses his job? Okay, he's a third grade teacher, now he lost his job. Now, where's his income going? He's not going to get another job real easily, I can tell you that. Not now. So why should we look at this guy's credit report and say, well, we can give you a home with no money down, or we can give you a better interest rate, or we're going to give you a loan, but not the guy with a lousy credit report, but he's saved up to 20% down. But he made a mistake in life, or when 2008, the bubble blew, his credit went down, just like the credit report of the bank should have. The credit report of the banks that got bailed out was zero. They were going bankrupt on Monday. Remember what they said to the president on Sunday night, on the weekend? Who was his name? The fellow that looks like Lurch, the big guy. Paulson. Yeah. Paulson called the president on a Sunday night. You know the story. He said if they didn't get a bailout, that the world was going to come to an end on Monday.
Donald Trump's not wise.
I would think that what he was telling the president is the credit report on these banks is zero, or at least it's going to be zero at 6 o'clock tomorrow morning. The president, you know, and the Senate and the Congress, they give these people $700 billion with no strings attached to help the other guys that they're supposed to lend money to businesses. Now, if they're in trouble, don't you think that Main Street's got problems? Oh, but you don't want to help the small businesses? Well, it's the tax money to pay for the government. All of it comes from the small businesses, every single dime, because they are the ones that employ the people, and they withhold the taxes, and then that money is used to pay taxes, and they pay taxes on the profits of the business, and that's where the money comes from for the businesses. So why bail out the bank who doesn't pay taxes versus bailing out the businesses. Because if they bailed out the businesses, the Internal Revenue Service would have been able to collect more money. But instead, they gave the money to the banks who did what? The way they ran away with no strings attached. I'd have run too. I think I could have ran faster than the bank.
Banks hired lawyers to foreclose on everybody.
Yeah, and then the banks foreclosed on everybody, and then how's that helping anything? I mean, these people lost their houses because of what? The bank didn't give them their line of credit that they promised them. See, there are people like me and like Lee. We had lines of credit in writing, six-figure lines of credit that we never used, never needed. We both went into negative cash flow, just like every other business around here. But you know what? Being good, honest, straight business people, we suffered the negative cash flow, took money out of our bank accounts personally. I mean, we took that money out of our own checking accounts and out of our own savings account. In some cases, we cashed in our IRA and our 401. Self-directed IRAs. I mean, we got money anywhere we could. Friends and relatives to keep our businesses going because our business has been open for decades. We had people and we're all barbecue friends with their relatives and with them. We couldn't just let them go. And Fox News is saying everything's going to turn around. The banks are getting bailed out. So we figure, well, okay, they're going to be liquid enough to honor their line when we ask them. So we didn't want to borrow the money until we had to. But guess what? When the day came, you know what they said? We don't have any money. Well, they got the bailout. Where'd the bailout money go? I'm looking around. Now, Lee has a separate bank than me. So when they said that to her, I went to my bank and they said, oh, we'll honor it, blah, 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 blah. Come back tomorrow. I signed some papers. They checked my credit. Everything was cool. They said, come back tomorrow and we'll have your platinum credit card here. And then you can transfer the six figures into your operating account so you can keep the negative cash flow going until things turn around. I came back the next day. I told you this story. You guys need to watch the other shows. And they pulled the next day when I went back to get the actual card with my name on it. They said, the president wants to talk to you in his private office. They called me into the back room and they said, we're going to tell you something, but you have to promise not to tell anyone else because we don't want there to be a run on the bank or a great scare. And the bottom line is, if you promise, I had to promise. And he said, we don't have any money. We don't have any money to make this kind of a loan. And I asked him, well, how could that be? And he said, well, because, and I said, how is it that you're able to make a mortgage loan? And he said, well, because the loans for the houses, they come from somewhere else. They come from Wall Street. And what we do is we front the money and then we get the money back and then we lend it to someone else and we get the money back and then we lend it to someone else and then we get the money back from Wall Street. But they couldn't do it on a commercial loan. So that was the end of that. We both closed our office. She closed her printing company and I closed my real estate company. We had to. It was costing me hundreds of dollars a day for advertising, to advertise listings that weren't going to sell. It's so sad. It's really sad. And then I had to go to continuing education to maintain my broker's license. I had to pay for that even though I wasn't open, just to maintain. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to reopen at a future day. How stupid is that? I know 100 times more than a teacher, but the government makes me go to continuing education. Meanwhile, you've got these government servants writing laws. Oh, but I guess they don't even write them because they're not allowed to see them, so I suppose you're not smart enough to write them. You know, I wrote my own contracts when I sold houses. Sometimes you use a typical FAR Bar contract, which is a Florida Assistant of Realtors contract. But many times I'd write my own contract. And when my computers got stolen, it was a serious loss because a lot of those contracts, if you were selling a particular kind of property, it had to have certain clauses in it. And I had proprietary contracts that were honed over the years. And they were drawn up by lawyers. And part of the contract was drawn by one lawyer, and then a couple years later I found out there was something wrong with it because something went wrong. There's another issue popped up. So it might have been a year later you sold another business or another property was similar, and you wanted to make sure that that item was covered, so you went back to your lawyer and they added another sentence or two. So now you're talking about contracts that were over a period of decades customized to my needs and to the needs of my clients. They would cover everything you could think of, so that if any dispute arose, everybody knew where they stood. Instead of relying on a judge in court who said it's allowed to lie, you're allowed to lie. See, I didn't like that. Once I, you know, that judge saying you're allowed to lie, I mean, kind of makes me wonder why I have a contract in the first place. And then Charlie Crist puts him up as, you know, a couple of weeks after he said that, he gets put on the Supreme Court without even being nominated. I already told you this. Why am I talking? But yeah, then they, after the judge said, but I guess I count it as a positive in my career. See, the other nominees, potential nominees for the GOP, they don't know this. They never had a Supreme Court judge look them in the eye and say lying is legal and explain why. Happened to me. He explained it to me. So I know, you know, I know that lying is legal and I know why. And I guess we all know now that the government's allowed to lie to us. I suppose he was giving me a heads up because this happened long before that NDAA thing said that propaganda is legal and lying to the public's legal. I guess this judge was giving me a heads up, so maybe I'll take it as a positive instead of a negative just because I lost a few bucks on my commission. At least I still got paid, but not the amount I was supposed to get, but... Look, folks, you know, businessmen cannot live in a system where lying is legal and a judge says lying is legal. You know, even if you stay home during the day, which I'm home a lot more now because I'm not active, and that's another reason why I want to run for office, because I need a job. And I can't think of a better job than fixing this country. And I don't see anybody else stepping up that has the credentials, the knowledge, or the ability to think out of the box like I do with new ideas, because we need new ideas. These other people are idiots. Or it's the same old crap going around in circles again, and you're going to bring the same oligarchs back. Oh, for God's sake, I can't think of a worse thing to happen. Be like getting that same judge again, you know, the guy who says you're allowed to lie. Oh, my God. How would you like to go on court with him? Okay, what else? Oh, yeah. So let's talk, just to finish up on the credit thing. If I had a client and I were a banker and the client came in and he said, look, I've got 20% down, but I had a divorce last year and it was a nightmare and my credit went down, or I lost my job, or he doesn't need to explain it at all. Doesn't matter. Maybe he never had credit at all. Or he had credit and something went wrong. Or he had a bankruptcy and it was explainable because he had an insane judge that did something to him. And his legal bill was $100,000 and he went bankrupt just because he wanted to wipe out the bullshit legal bill that he never should have been charged in the first place, because lying should not have been legal. Lying should have been illegal. See, I say that once you make that loan, your risk is that the guy might lose his job. That's the risk. Because if the guy, you know, if everything stays status quo and the man continues to go to work every day, has a job, doesn't change, he can pay his loan, the one that you just gave him. But you gave him the loan with no money down because he had a good credit rating, because he was a teacher. Teachers aren't affected by the ups and downs of, so, you know, if you hire, or maybe he was a public servant, so. Public servants, that's why they're all running for president. They're only ones that weren't harmed by the bubble. But they're the ones that you shouldn't put in, because they don't know what the bubble can do to you. They know, they don't know that the bubble should, that you need to stop the bubble from forming. And then once, if it does form, they don't know how to stop it. And they don't know how to remediate it properly like I do. and they don't know how to fix the damage. See, I'm a damage repair expert, being an insurance adjuster. I repaired every kind of house. I saw every kind of damage imaginable, including additional living expenses, how to get these people somewhere to live when there's nothing available. Oh, God, I've seen it all, folks. These other potential nominees, they haven't lived it. I have. I have answers that will permanently fix the problems that we're confronted with today as a nation. If I were the banker, getting back to the matter at hand, the bullet point here, if the worst happens and the man loses his job and can't pay and you need to take the house back, the house is going to be there. But if you gave the house to the guy with no down payment because his credit was good at the time, well, yeah, everybody's credit was good before the bubble burst. Now the guy lost his job. His credit went down. He's not working. He wants to stay living in his house. Can't afford it anymore, clearly. So what are you going to do to help him? Well, underwriting guidelines at your bank say you can't give him a loan or a refi unless his credit's a certain level. Well, that's not happening. But if you hadn't made him the loan in the first place, unless he had 20% down, well, when you take the house back, you're covered. The bank is not in a position where it's going to lose anything, because if the house is a $100,000 house and you sell it for $80,000, well, guess what? You got your $80,000 back. And if some of it was insured with a mortgage insurance protection, there's no loss to anybody. But if you give the guy the house with no money down, or how about as a second house or a third house? Oh, my God, on and on and on. The most important thing is the down payment, folks. Don't worry about the credit report. The credit report is bullshit. It's kind of like, where are you going to eat lunch today? You're going to go to McDonald's or Burger King? Or St. John's Pizza Corporation? It's different every day. The credit report goes up and down. It's like the weather. Bad weather hits. But you know what? The house is always going to be there. The boss can't lay off the house. Now, it might burn down. So you have insurance for that. Bank still didn't lose. Listen, folks, I think that's about it for today. But one last thing I want to say as proof that these guys are just evil and bad to the core. About a month ago, the United States government said that we will provide non-lethal aid to the Ukraine, to Chocolate Man, so they could go and, talk the terrorists into surrendering. Not the terrorists. They're not terrorists. So that they could take their other part of the country back, which they're never going to get back. Doesn't belong to them. Legally doesn't belong to them. It's got nothing to do with force. It legally doesn't belong to them. But let's just say he wants to take it back. So now you're providing non-lethal aid. And I saw the Air Force cargo plane landing. I saw the front opening. I saw the Humvee coming out. I saw the Chocolate Man himself get into the Humvee and drive it down the ramp. And it had it was the new kind of Humvee, with the machine gun nest at the top that rotates around. I'm talking about the nice one with the thick glass and the windows, the upgraded one. That's a nice ride, by the way. But anyway, the only thing that was missing was the gun, which they could buy from anywhere. But it was non-lethal aid. Now, here we are, advanced the calendar to a couple of days ago. Well, last night I'm watching YouTube because I couldn't sleep, because I'm worried about what's going on over there. And I like to know what's happening around the world. And I know watching, I could get more information off the computer by knowing where to look. And I can actually see the video and I can hear the people talking and get the translations. And that's where your truth really comes from. The freedom of speech of the internet, which is another reason why you don't want to close. The internet's the only thing that's working right, so you don't want to mess with the internet. And I saw a whole column of the same Humvees that were being unloaded from the Air Force cargo plane by Chocolate Man coming down the road, and they all had the 50 caliber machine guns, and to tell you the truth, the resolution of the camera wasn't good enough, but it looked to me like they were automatic grenade launchers that they had installed up there where the 50 cals would have been. So that was either a 50 cal or a automatic grenade launcher, which, as you know, was a terrible weapon if you're on the receiving end of that thing. You don't want to be on the receiving end of an automatic grenade launcher off a Humvee. No, it'll kill you right away, and they'll knock your building down that you're in. But it doesn't matter. The Russians are gonna win. They're gonna tear those Humvees up like they're just eggs. They're gonna shoot at them, and they're gonna fall apart like eggs. Everybody inside, they're all gonna be wiped out. They're all gonna die, fighting for nothing. And they could all be friends. They were friends until we got involved. I promise you, folks, I'm not gonna let the United States get bogged down in the Ukraine. The Ukraine, at least the eastern part of Ukraine, where they voted to join the Russian Federation, and the Russian Federation accepted in the Crimea, is part of Russia now. I already told you this. Go back and look at my other movie. Bottom line is, we lied. We lied right on national television, but of course it's legal. If you want to live in a country where it's legal to lie. See, this is why the rest of the world doesn't want to deal with us anymore. It's why we're going to have our asses handed to us. Because China, like I said, the Chinese leadership was right there sitting in the skybox watching the parade for the 70th anniversary of the end of the war. They're showing that they're going to help. Those Armada tanks, I wouldn't be surprised if they're coming from China. Reports of it, or the idea of it, or being made in China and shipped to, you know. Russia and China together can kick our ass right off the planet. Thank God they don't think like us. Otherwise, they'd attack us straight away. They would first call us terrorists, then they would call us liars, then they would call us Nazis, and they would start provoking us and attacking us. As it is, all they're doing is leaving us alone. Because they know we're going to just kill ourselves is what we're doing. And if you leave it to your congressman and your senator to run again for office and get back in there, or to be elevated to the level of the presidency or get cabinet positions, you're just going to hasten it. And you're going to have the same old. That's why I told you that I'm declaring a strike. I am declaring a strike. Call it the Zen of Ben strike. See, here's another idea from Ben. The mind of Ben. You know, my friend calls me the mind of Minolta because I have so many ideas. Only from the mind of Cola. And then he says Minolta, because it used to be the tagline for Minolta. Only from the mind of Minolta. He calls it from the mind of Cola. Because I have so many ideas. Like my father, think tank engineer, was so smart, all they did was put him in a room. All his life he worked in a room with other engineers, and all they did was think. That's all he did all day, was think. His whole career. Google him. You should Google my father. He passed away. Benjamin Cola, Haddonfield, New Jersey, obituary. And if that's not, and believe me, that's nothing compared to the whole deal, because it's so secret they can't tell you. But he wasn't allowed to talk about a lot of stuff. He did a lot of stuff that's not on here. And that I witnessed, even things that he did at the house were almost as if it was alien technology right there in the house. And if you think that that was just a fluke, that he's smart, his older brother, Rudy, R-U-D-Y, Rudy Cola from Malvern, Pennsylvania. Google Rudy Cola. He passed away 3 years ago or so. And Google his obituary. Also born in Philadelphia, like my father and me. And you see how smart Rudy was. He invented the flat screen TV and all the attachments that make it work better. He has 23 patents in his name. He's a physicist. A decorated vet from World War II. These are geniuses I just happened to come from Italy. And the genes came straight down to me. I'm a purebred. I'm not an intermix. I'm not part Dutch. I'm not part British. I'm 100% Italian, Roman. I don't know if that's good or bad. All I know is I do have a lot of ideas like my father and my Uncle Rudy. These people are geniuses. Now, I don't have the mathematical genius that they have, but I have the physics, I have the civil genius, how to fix these problems of government, these civil problems. And by some stroke of luck, I suppose, I just turned out to be a very good salesman. Always was a good salesman. I won the, when I was a newspaper boy, my sales career started. I won just by selling newspaper subscriptions, I won a week free trip to Miami. They flew me on a 707 at the age of 7 or 8 years old to lay on the beach at the Barcelona Hotel in Miami. Yeah, it was fun. They had chaperones, but yeah, a few of us won. We had to sell a lot of newspaper subscriptions, but at a very young age, I went to Washington, D.C. before I was 10 years old, winning one of these. I saw the Washington Monument, I went toward the White House, all as under 10 years old. All I was a newspaper boy. But because I sold so much, they took me to Washington, D.C. And I went to New York, and I went to the U.N. at that young age. I went to see the Liberty. Well, I was born around the corner from the Liberty Bell, which is my final bullet point. You know, if you're wondering, hey, you know, is this COLA guy really going to give us our Constitution back? Which is what I'm going to do. I mean, everything I'm saying is basically going back to, hey, we need to get the Constitution back. We're going to go through every single law on the books, and we're going to strike it if it doesn't come up to constitutional par. If it doesn't smell right, it's going bye-bye. And what we'll do is we're going to set up sections of the country, each so many 100,000 people will have a team of few lawyers, and they'll be constitutional experts, and they're going to go through all the laws, including ordinances, state laws, and they're going to strike everything out of existence. And then I will sign whatever needs to be signed to throw all these laws out. We have far too many laws, rules, regulations, and procedures on the books that are complete violations of the Constitution. And I'm not going to throw anybody in jail or anything like that up until that point. Now, going forward from there, once everybody is made aware of this, then the door will close, the hatchet will come down, the hammer will drop. And then if the police violate your civil rights, if the government does something and passes a bad law, whoever signs it's going to be in trouble. If they don't represent you properly, I'll withhold their pay. I mean, we're going to straighten this crap out, folks. We're not going to have these people writing laws that they're backed by the lobbyists who are really writing the laws and your congressman can't read them. No. Sign it first and read it later, like Pelosi said. No. If that happens after I get in power and after we drop that hammer and after everybody's aware of it, Nancy Pelosi, you know, by virtue of even saying something like that, is going to be in trouble. And if she does it or encourages somebody to do it, she's going to be in trouble for racketeering and trying to induce somebody to violate the law, and she's going to go to jail for violating the Constitution or even trying to induce somebody to violate the Constitution. Because the violating of the Constitution is what's ruining it for us. I grew up in a time, I'm 60 years old, so I know what this country is supposed to run like. I know how much fun you're supposed to be able to have. I know what your rights are supposed to look like and be like and feel like. I lived it. It was wonderful. This was a completely different country, like a different world. Life was good. Now I go down the street, real frankly, I'm scared. I worry about being pulled over by the police and maybe shot for nothing. You know, I wonder maybe there's certain kind of clothes I should wear to make me look like I'm not going to make me look non-threatening to the police so I don't get shot on sight for something. No, I'm just kidding about that. But the point is, our business owners are hamstrung by all these rules and regulations. And as soon as you go signing a trade agreement, then you're locking yourself into a bunch of rules. Because if you sign a statement that says anything, then you've got to live by that statement. And anytime you make a statement, you're restricting your ability to contravene that statement in the future. So if it's not directly making a law, it's making policy that's affecting the future. Every time you make any kind of a rule or a regulation or a law or a trade agreement, you're subjecting yourself to something. You're forcing yourself to behave a certain way. And these trade agreements are just turning people into oligarchs. That's what it's doing. And it's putting all the other small business owners, small companies at a disadvantage. I cut short what I was saying about, go back into the late 90s, the Congress was thinking about allowing people to import their medications from overseas. So I went to GoDaddy.com and I had reserved, I think, about 30 or 40 names, like Medication for Less, Drugs.com. I mean, I reserved every internet name under the sun as an investment, because I figured, well, this law is going to pass, and I figure eventually you're going to be able to buy your medication through the internet, and I'll own all these domain names. I'll be able to sell them for, tens of thousands of dollars, and I only pay $15 for the name, but I'll be able to sell the name for $10,000 once that law passes. And it was for that reason only, because I was reading the paper every day, and it was in the paper. And it's funny because for years, it didn't pass. So I basically lost my money. It wasn't much. It was a long shot. It wasn't really a long shot. I mean, I kind of thought it would pass, and I figure eventually it'll still pass. If I'm in power, it sure would pass. But to this day, people still say, Ben Cole is a drug dealer, and, he's got all these, he's reserved all these domain names and everything. And it had nothing to do with being me wanting to be or trying to be a drug dealer, which I wasn't. I reserved the names because the Congress was going to pass a law that was going to legalize purchase of drugs through the internet. So as a smart businessman who read the newspaper on there, well, call GoDaddy and I can go reserve all these names. That's what I did. Allstate found out about that too, and they started to think I was some kind of a mad. They thought I was a kingpin drug dealer when they saw I had 30 names. Maybe that was why they got pissed off at me. But that's all that was. And that's no excuse anyway. They're going down with me. So that's where I stand. If you're at heads with yourself and you're thinking, we need to put somebody in there. Who are we going to put in there? Follow my guideline. Don't put anybody in there who's been in there before. Don't put any friends or relatives or family members of the same. Don't re-elect these same people. Even Jeb Bush himself said he would have invaded Iraq. And we even know, even with the knowledge now, he said he would have invaded Iraq. So you see, these people are just, they're insane. They're absolutely insane. And then even if you don't believe that, and it's still a toss-up in your brain, here's how you should think. You should think to yourself, do I want the Constitution or not? Yes, you do. Do I want somebody who's a billionaire to be in power as the president? No. I want somebody who's got the credentials of Ben Cole, who knows everything about real estate, insurance, and securities, and ran his own gig as himself and never had a government job. Yes, I want that kind of person. Then if it comes down to a choice between two or three people like that, well, I would say you're not going to get two or three people like that, because there aren't two or three people like that, I think, that have those credentials, all of them, and have had the kinds of experiences that I've had. But then even if that's true, you know who I'd vote for? And I'd vote for the person who has those credentials and the best person with the best ability to convince and persuade. That would be the best salesman, because when you're running the country, you have to be able to persuade people. You have to be able to get on the phone and persuade them that your way is best. You have to be able to go overseas and talk to Vladimir Putin and shake his hand and understand what he's all about and look him in the eye, and you have to be able to sell him on what you want him to do. So you want the best salesman too, on top of the credentials. But even then, if you have somebody that has all that and it's still a toss-up and you don't know who to nominate or who to vote for, it's very simple. It's even easier than tossing a coin heads or tails. Here's what you do. You take out a map of the United States. Okay, and you go to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and you put a circle around where the Liberty Bell is, where the founding fathers used to live, and where they still are. The dead bodies are buried there. And I would say, whoever was born the closest to the Liberty Bell, he's your man. And just call it a toss up, or just call it a soulful answer to a difficult question: who to vote for. And you're asking God, who do I vote for? They all look like they have their benefits. Keep in mind, it's the Constitution that you want. And so now, once you have narrowed it down to the people who are going to really hammer that Constitution home and call it a criminal act if you violate it, not just a civil, oh, okay, we're going to let somebody go because they violated his rights. No, whoever violated his rights goes to jail. Turn it into a criminal act. But what you do is you look at the map and you say, okay, Ted Cruz, you know, first of all, he's out because he's in now. So he's out anyway. But let's just say he wasn't in. So you got this guy here, one guy in California, you got a guy in Oklahoma. Ben Cola was born around the corner from the Liberty Bell. He was within eyeball sight of the Liberty Bell when he was born. Call it a Zen-like decision. I mean, some people tell me they go to the voting box and they just throw a coin and they don't know who to vote for. I'm going to make it easy. Whoever was born closest to the Liberty Bell, that's where their heart is. They're closest to the Liberty Bell. They weren't born in Bongo Bongo. They weren't born in Mexico. They weren't born in Canada. They were born right there. So I'll make it easy for you. Vote for Ben Cola. We're going to be circulating a petition because I need to have your signature on a petition so that I can just get onto the ballot, so that I can have a chance to run for president. Because I can't have a chance to run for president unless you sign a document that says that I'd like Ben to have a chance. So that doesn't vote for me. That just says put Ben on the ballot to see how he does. So please, when you get that signed, I need a lot, like a million of those. And you'll be able to do it, I believe, through the internet. We're still working with our lawyer on that, and we're constructing the website now. So we're going to figure out how to make it so that you can legally sign it on the internet, and that it'll count. Anyway, watch the other shows I made. And look, folks, because I'm new at this, sitting in front of a camera and talking and everything like that, the first couple of videos I did, like Ben, the beginning of Ben's life, and I speak a little slow, and please don't hold it against me. I'm just getting warmed up, and I hadn't been in front of a camera in a long time. I don't actually never did a monologue in front of a camera before. It was always me and face-to-face, and so it made me a little nervous. And so my first few videos, please don't hold it against me how fast I was speaking or my pace and everything. It's the words that matter, and you'll see that my pace picks up and I get a little more accustomed to looking at the camera. Funny thing is, I was trying to look you right in the eye as I was talking to you on these early videos. I didn't know what to do, so I took a picture of a person and I cut out the eyeballs. And so in that first video where it says Ben, the beginning of Ben's adult life, there was actually a picture of a person there with the eyeballs cut out. I mean, it was silly. I mean, I did everything I could to try to, and I had big lights shining and it was blinding my eyes. And I didn't know I needed, you know, I thought I needed a lot of light. And frankly, I was trying to get used to a lot of lights, thinking that at some point they're going to shine a lot of lights in my face, and I didn't want to be shocked and maybe lose my train of thought. So I was practicing shining the big lights in my eyes. And so that's why these first few videos look a little shaky and I seem a little bit nervous. But you see, these videos are going to get smoother and smoother as I go along. But in any case, when the website will be opening soon, and I hate to hit you up but if you could PayPal me, and you know we have a PayPal set up for this, PayPal me to BenjaminCola@AOL.com. It's BenjaminCola@AOL.com, or just call me, and just send a PayPal gift. You know how to do it, just through PayPal. Just put in a gift or whatever you can donate. It'll help us pay for the whole thing. Because I have to tell you, folks, Vice President tells you, oh, well, I'm poor, I don't even have a bank account. That's another, don't believe that bullcrap, folks. I really don't have the ability to just whip out tens of thousands of dollars to build a website that I need to do this. I truly need help to do this. I used to have that kind of money. It was pocket change to me years ago when the real estate thing, before the bubble hit. But I don't now. And by the way, I was self-made. Nobody helped me. When I asked my parents years ago to help me get started, they refused. I did everything myself. So I'm a self-made man, whatever man I turned out to be. I'm a self-made man. And I've never been arrested. A perfectly clean record. So I'm honest. Do not lie. Lying to me would be breaking one of the Ten Commandments. And I believe wholeheartedly in the Ten Commandments. I pray every day. And you know what I pray for? I pray for this country. I pray for you. I pray for good health. And I pray that our Constitution is restored. And I pray to God to give me the strength to do it. Because I don't see anybody out there that knows what I know and knows how to do it. I do know how to do it. I know what to do. I know what to do. I know what needs to be done. So I'll just leave it at that, folks. I really love you very much, and I do pray for you. So have a great day. And thank you so much for listening to me and considering me and helping me to get nominated, so that I can have a chance. Okay, thank you.